Guys, welcome back. All right. So we got some
well,
semifinal
apparently
action for you
sitting, so I
guys.
guess I'd reach just sit, so it's
Yep.
cool.
Isn't this cooler though? Isn't this nicer? A bit more chill?
Yeah, I guess so. Just Shrivka looks kinda like a little puppet, not an actual
I can
human
just
being.
make him look better. There we go.
Alright, good. Welcome back everybody to the ATLC Championship Sunday. It's time to find out who's going to go to the finals to play against Cloud9 and challenge Strifecrow, Kalepto, and Ekot for the crown.
That's right.
Being season one champions and winning $150,000. I'm joined by Crip. I'm joined by Strifecrow. How's it going, Colin?
Good. Good.
So you're gonna be sizing up the competition now,
sizing
I guess.
Up competition, getting like a better view from the caster's desk.
Yeah, kind of analyze it.
It's because there's some room to sit down here, right?
Oh
in the lobby with all the plebeians. Strife, right?
Yeah.
Dang, I had no idea.
Well, it is gonna be Valuetown versus Nilum, the rematch. You have a favorite here? Is there a team you guys would
I guess
would more like to see against
Nilum win?
Nilum.
Just because I guess we haven't played them yet, and yeah, it's nice to be
beat
able
everybody.
To beat everyone.
Yeah,
you
it's
think
not like you avoided
like,
anybody. You just
no,
kind of.
I think that would be at this point. It'd be like very majestic to beat everybody. You know, like very clean victory.
Right, but for Nilum to be in the finals, they would be basically playing the fourth game in a row today.
Oh yeah, and that
so
they,
should that,
be good
that,
for us.
Yeah, that should be great for you guys.
You have like all information. They might as well just give you their deck list.
And
at this
in fact, I feel like I have them already.
All right, well, we'll look forward to see what they have. I mean, Valuetown does have a pretty good streak going on for them. You know, they got stumbled against Cloud9, but they've looked pretty decent against other teams. I mean, the previous years versus Nylon went Valuetown's way.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. They're a very strong team. So
yeah.
Before I came here, we thought that they were like the second scariest team. So, yeah.
My main thoughts with Valuetown is that Dog has to have the heavy burden of the patron warrior that he really hasn't played as much as some of the other players.
Yeah.
And they usually leave him last. So the pressure was on him. And yesterday, you know, things didn't really go his way. He got some horrific draws with some of his decks. And I thought that might weigh him down a bit. But today it's been going okay for his team and Dog himself.
Yeah, and he's bringing the Rogue. That's the cool first appearance
Bold.
Of the Rogue. And I think Rogue's very underrated right now. But we'll talk more about that when we get to that bridge. In the meantime, Kibler is going to start things off with Hunter up against Life Coach's Handlock. Now, this is the advantage that Valuetown has. It's a Demon Handlock.
Demon Handlock.
Demon Lock is still different.
Right,
from
it's Zooey. Right.
Yeah.
You know, it has like
Demon Handlock, that's right.
A lot of demon approaches like Bane of Doom and Implosion.
Yeah, I guess the difference is when you have Molten Giants, you kind of count yourself
yeah.
as a Handlock.
Even Mountain Giants as well.
Yeah. I guess it's kind of an artificial kind of definition, but it's what people go by, so.
Artificial?
Yeah.
It's as real as it gets.
Why?
Because you have demons, but you still play Handlock.
You still
mean,
play Handlock style.
Like, yeah.
Give me the cards.
Yeah, you life tap, and you keep your hand
okay.
size as big as
okay.
possible. So, except you just, instead of removal and like a lot of mid-sized minions.
But there's like Malygos Warlock, which also likes to keep their hands.
It's
possible,
got like the Imp Gang bosses and
okay.
stuff, and more early game usage.
And it's also a lot of dragons now, too. So it's more of dragon demon block.
The one thing seeing some of Life Coach game, I didn't quite get to see all of them, so maybe I'm wrong about this, but I didn't see the third demon besides the Void Callers. There was Mal'Ganis, Jiraxxus, the two Void Callers.
I saw the Doomguard.
Oh, there was a
Doomguard?
Oh, okay.
So I'm guessing that's the first
And we had a conversation about that. You mentioned how you like the fearsome
Doomguard. I like fearsome Doomguards.
Instead
man.
Of Doomguard.
They're cool.
I don't like it.
Well, sorry,
like
sorry,
it,
Froden.
Strifecrow,
do not agree.
Here, this is, there's, must be news to you, but you don't have to like it.
Uh-oh.
You can stay over there and let me be a pleb.
Okay.
All right, well, Hunter versus the Handlock here. Has this changed a lot since TGT came out, in your opinion, Strifecrow?
I actually don't think so. This is like a matchup where I feel like there's not really new cards. The Hunter, as long as, like, this kind of Hunter, at least, not something like Lock and Load, and the Handlock has gone probably like the least amount of changes as far as like any of the TGT.
I think
stuff
both
goes.
Of these decks literally have
zero
new cards.
Even, so I guess
zero
not.
New cards?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. How do you know? Kibler might put it a bear trap in it.
Yeah.
No.
Maybe.
He's not Gaara.
Yeah.
Well, one thing is I saw Kibler had a flare in his Hunter, which is going to hurt in this matchup a little bit, since I'm guessing it'll counter to Freeze Mage and Secret Paladin.
I'm hoping that sees some play.
Yeah.
I had a Kazan Mystic yesterday, and it triggered against a Warrior.
This matchup.
What would happen?
He played a Nexus champion.
God. Well, hopefully that doesn't happen, I guess, in this scenario. It's kind of weird stuff.
Yeah.
But the whole impetus is on the Hunter to set up a way to kill the Handlock without, you know, provoking the wrath of Molten Giants before it can answer it.
Yeah, yeah. Or having enough like burn at the end to finish it off. It's true. Very important for Hunter to have a high damage opening like this, something like Abusive and Knife Juggler getting in a lot of early damage, just because if you're playing a very weak opening, they can life tap easily and start playing very greedy four drops, whereas if you play a lot of early minions, it's hard for them to really go for that. Lifecoat still managed to kind of tap his way to turn four. Usually you don't see Handlock able to play Mountain Giant in this matchup on turn four.
No, they're considered dead cards. But you know what isn't a dead card? A Fearsome Doomguard. If you play the Voidcaller and you had the Fearsome Doomguard come out...
Well, it would be instead of the Doomguard, so you wouldn't have it.
They can't even BGH it.
They can definitely freeze trap it, though.
They could.
Yeah. Or ignore it.
But you wait for the Defender of Argus again.
Okay.
Or the Sunfury.
All right. But then if you Defender of Argus, you can BGH.
So you wait for the Sunfury protection.
Oh, you sold me.
Yeah.
I'm sold.
There it is. Just never Defender of
Argus. All right. The other thing that I think the Hunter really requires in this matchup is like a finisher card. Like, even though you might have a very aggressive opener, if you don't have a Kill Command or a Quick Shot in the later stages of the game, you just can't go for that push to play around Moltons.
Yeah. Sometimes even both. You know, like, the Handlock's really good at, like, flirting with death all the time because two heal bots are still standard. Mm-hmm. You have so many defensive options. And, you know, Life Coach, when you play the Mountain Giant, you're, like, accepting double damage. You're expecting the fact that this probably won't end up being traded in.
This will be painful.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say, I think last turn, Kibler should have coined out the Abusive because he is already playing around Hellfire by having a 2-4 up, and you kind of really want to hit the breakpoint because, like, if he played one more minion last turn with the Abusive, it's very likely that this play that Life Coach did wouldn't really work out for him. Mm-hmm. Even though this doesn't really work out completely for Life Coach, it's, like, still reasonable to just leave up the board and play 8-8 here, whereas if he played one more Abusive last turn, I feel like it would pretty much be too much damage to play a minion into the board.
Yeah, let's see. 5, 8, 10.
You have to 14. Do something here. It's do you go into Moltons or do you wait? I think you can wait a bit.
There's almost no way this is going to be a wait. The problem is, like, if you want to wait in this matchup, you have to be able to make sure that the turn that you do finally decide to bring them into Molten range is going to be better than this turn. And I feel like the longer you wait at this point, the worse it's going to get for you, since you don't have things like High Main.
Huh.
Well, he chose to wait.
And he goes for the Freezing Trap instead. I mean, it kind of makes it that these Freezing Traps need to sort of find a way to be played. Otherwise, cards like Quickshot won't even really have its impact. But that's also kind of unfortunate that he drew two of his Freezing Traps when his mana size is in hand.
The way that Kibler chose to circumvent the problem was by playing the Freezing Trap. Because Freezing Trap allows the option of not bringing Life Coach down to 10. So it might be that the turn he brings him down to 10, it'll look better. This is very, very risky against...
It also looks terrifying if you're Life Coach. You see that, you're like, oh, okay, so I have to not die next turn. So Life Coach, instead of making an aggressive play, he's going to make a defensive play.
Yeah.
Well, here he wants to taunt up the Mountain Giant, and he needs an extra card to be able to play both of them without tapping. I think that's the idea, at least. That's the key. He can also Dark Bomb the Juggler, but that seems a little optimistic.
I mean, it's still gaining you a big amount of health by doing that. Like, the 5 health will be chipped away from the Giant anyways. Maybe even more. Like, one Juggle plus Abuse Sword can get through this Giant.
He almost has enough damage to go through, and if there's... Oh!
Whoa.
That's a lot of synergy.
Dogs.
That's a lot of synergy.
Three damage dogs.
Yeah.
Even though there's only two dogs, there's...
Those are Wolf Riders.
Those are really good dogs.
Summon two Wolf Riders for 3 mana?
Yeah.
Man.
Yes, please.
It's almost like those deserve to get crackled each.
5, 8, 14, 20, 22, and your opponent has 21 effective health?
I think you have to...
Thank you.
quickly.
Coach has ways to kill himself four times over. I mean, this has to hit the heal bot, right?
Okay.
Oh, the heal bot.
That one.
And then kill the Joker, play Molten Heal Bot.
But it's more risky to some things. I feel like you have to go for the high risk play.
Yeah, because you are really behind.
Mm-hmm.
So, just any bit of damage from Kibler.
Silence, damage, even a juggle might do it.
Mm-hmm. A lot of outs.
And oh, that I didn't even see what that was, but I guess it was good enough.
Insta-call. Kibler continues his streak. He's been doing very well.
Just can't lose.
He just won't lose.
Has he lost?
He's lost once.
In this, in the finals?
Turn three boom.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Man, Kibler sucks.
Yeah.
Can't even beat a turn three Dr. Boom.
He didn't play around it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to expect that.
He needed to play Mana Wraith. So then you can't innervate twice and play Dr. Boom.
Okay. Well, now we know.
Shrivecrow's IQ is dropping by the minute here. So just bear with us, Shrive. You only have to go.
This is a bad omen before a match.
Wow. All right. Well. We'll step up the level, okay?
Okay.
We're not going to troll as much.
Okay.
So, going to game two here, I don't know if that was, like, such a big win.
And I know Handlock was struggling before the finals, and we see it struggling with Life Coach behind it. I mean, Life Coach is a pretty good pilot for the deck, I've heard. It's just not really working out. Handlock's one of those, or Handlock-ish decks, like Demon Handlock, is one of those decks that usually just stays alive enough and then suddenly takes back the game and wins. It just seems like you don't really get to that stage as frequently as you used to before TGT.
I always feel like Handlock, and this is just a theory, Shrefer, you can correct me, but I always feel like Handlock has to wait for the meta to completely settle before it starts becoming good a lot of times, because there's so many things that are variable and changing that you're not exactly sure. Like, Paladin lists are so... They float so much now. Like, are they playing one true silvers? Or they're like, are they playing divine favors? Are they scaling to mid range?
Mm-hmm.
And because of all this dynamics, like, it's really hard to play around everything perfectly. And versus Handlock, you always have to be making sure that you're playing around the right amount of cards and percentages and probability.
But doesn't that make Handlock always a good deck in tournaments where you know what you're playing against? Which he is now.
As time goes on, I think as time goes on, like, Handlock gets better after each content release. But that's just my theory.
Yeah.
We nailed it.
I was gonna say control decks in general, it's better when the meta settles down, since when you're playing a reactive control deck, it benefits you a lot to know the cards your opponents are playing. So with all the variation in Paladin and just in everything right now, since there's like a new expansion, so the deck lists in general aren't very settled yet, so it's hard to play a controlled deck like that.
Do you have an opinion on the fact that Value Time didn't even bring Paladin at all? Because I was under the impression it was one of the best decks considered in the current meta. And the fact is, they're not even bringing the class whatsoever.
That's interesting. I didn't notice until now. But I thought almost for sure that everyone was going to bring Paladin. They had Paladin in the first round before.
Exactly.
So they switched it for Rogue.
Yeah.
I'm also finding a bit surprising that with Paladin being so popular, Patron Warrior always being played, Hunter always being played, why we see so few Harrisons.
That's true. I feel like Harrison's been rotated out of the meta too for a lot of classes. I mean, Druid still plays it. I think Dog was playing it in his Druid, but Trump's
unsuccessfully though.
That's true. I mean, Trump did bring Druid this time.
In this format, with six classes, it's not as easy to bring tech cards like Harrison Jones.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when there's like three classes and you're expecting someone to bring a class that's more to Harrison Jones or even like two or three, then it's very easy. But with six, it's like any tech card, since you never get to like snipe any matchup in Conquest, it's more like random. You're very likely just not going to be able to run into the matchup that the Harrison is good. So,
and then that's when Eloise brings Blingtron because no one's playing the Harrison.
Mm-hmm. It's gonna be Kibler on Priest, RDU on Paladin. Should be pretty fun. It's just gonna be a total brawl on the board.
Yeah, it's gonna be the Priest trying to stop the aggression of the Paladin. But one thing that Priest, we saw from Gaara, for example, just like if it doesn't get those early game draws, it's almost laughably one sided. Like Priest is still back to her old ways of, oh, I don't have a 2-drop. Oh, I don't have anything to buff with Valiant Chosen. I guess I lose.
The Dragon Priest is very much like tempo based right now, more than the Control Priest before. So if you actually do fall behind, you don't have as many comeback mechanics as the old Priest.
It's true.
These Paladins very, very quick. So
we saw Gaara run double Holy Nova, but do you know if Kibler's running double Holy Nova in the one in the finals here?
I think there's always two Holy Novas, but then I don't think Kibler has probably no Chill Mall, probably no Light Bomb.
He had the Light Bomb in yesterday's version. Oh, okay, no, it was in yesterday's version. Did he show it in today's?
No, I mean today he hasn't played. He hasn't played in with his new deck yet. Because he had to resubmit between the first match and the second.
Yeah, that's right.
There's a resubmission
for
him. So
So he could have anything.
Technically, we're not sure.
Yeah.
If this is even a Dragon Priest.
But Pyromancer Priest.
Dragon Master.
Dragon Master?
Pretty unlikely.
I mean, what if he just whips out Zedalot's Prophet Valen Priest? That'd be pretty awesome.
Pretty awesome.
I think there is some chance that you'd actually bring like old control Pyro Priest. I think that's just a good deck against, you know, junk minions, which literally every deck is playing right now.
Yeah, and that's one of the big comeback mechanics of Priest, the Pyromancer. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the most noticeable omissions in the new Dragon Priest. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I personally like how Dragon Priest is taking direction. It just fits like a different style of Priest versus like Control Priest would always be stuck passing a lot and like, okay, now do I circle? No. Now do I circle? Yeah, you know, that kind of thing. It's just like, it becomes this weird tense thing. And of course, Priest sometimes doesn't have it, so it's really inconsistent.
Right. Yeah, Priest has always been a bit of an inconsistent class. Mm-hmm. Even with Dragon Priest doing very well and Ladder doing very well just to stop the aggression. Ooh. We saw some hands in this tournament even where just nothing really gets going.
A double Kibler Strike. He's going game number two, and he could easily lock his best record in ATLC history if he just wins here, and then Value Town continues to move on.
Value Town, just they're doing a strat where they just like throw out Kibler and start us off with 2-0.
And then let Dog clean up for better or for worse.
Also, RDU is playing actually a buff-heavy Paladin. Like, he's got the Blessing of Mites and the Kings. If Kibler sticks on the board early on, he might do exactly the opposite of what we talked about. Instead of the Paladin denying the creature on the priest denying the creature on the Paladin.
Yeah, definitely a big thing. So, like, both of the decks have a lot of buffs, even with Villains Chosen.
Yeah, they're both just going to snowball.
I feel like the early battle is so important here. Mm-hmm. Whoever wins the early battle. Because if you, say, get a creeper and then a Blessing of Kings on the creeper, and you just, like, trade, you know, super efficiently.
I actually think that's a really good hand from RDU. He's got the redemption for the creeper with double Blessing of Kings. That basically means there's going to be a turn 3 Blessing of Kings, and there's going to be a turn 4 Blessing of Kings. There's, like, how do you escape
that? I didn't think about it that way.
Yeah, that's interesting, because of your redemption turn 1, your creeper can't even be killed.
Right.
Yeah. It spawns more 1-1, so even if it does get killed, there's 4 targets where you can
there
use it.
Is a death, but with 2 kings, and there's another creeper that gets blessed.
Exactly.
So we'll have to see. Wow, 1-7 like cleric.
That does not die to the king's creeper, actually.
Totally not expected.
Well, it can't even kill the haunted creeper right now.
Ooh. Well, it can kill that. But turns out it's actually better not to play the.
He's going
to
Worm Rest Agent the Face? Okay.
Oh no! You have to play around kings.
You attack into it.
He doesn't know what secret this is, but regardless, like, Noble Sack, it's the same. I'm not really sure. Does some damage to the creeper.
Alright, well, there goes the kings to kill the Worm Rest. You really can't seriously expect Kibler to play around that.
This is actually really cool for RDU, because you have to expect this 5-3 to be killed. Right, it's a 5-3, it does a lot of damage, low life. But if it gets killed, then redemption procs. So,
what if you don't force your opponent to do it? You play.
Yeah, I like the Guardian here.
Yeah.
But then you play. Does he play a second Blessing of Kings?
Yeah.
Okay. And I mean, if Shadow or Death.
If you're RDU, you'd think that, you know, well, if he had Shadow or Death, he probably would have used it. Yeah. Like, Drake doesn't seem that much better or better at all. So
it's pretty scary, the Seeker. I feel like there's no way that RDU would play True Silver to kill the Twilight Garden here, because then you're losing your 5-3 on the trade, right. And then your redemption is going to be ruined with the
right.
Spiders. So he has to play the Second Kings here. And then it's like the true test of awkwardness for Kibler, because then it's like a 9 health minion, yeah. A 9 attack minion, and if you kill it, it's redemption. So,
but the redemption at that stage is kind of fine.
Yeah,
he doesn't know there's also a blessing of might that's going to come down.
It gives him like an opportunity to also finally utilize like Northshire Cleric's health. There's a lot of 1/1 targets. Yeah. I mean, in the end, it's like, oh, it's a 1/1. Hanakuri that spawns 1/1. I can keep drawing it until I get my pirate.
It's kind of weird how strong these like junk spiders or whatever creatures are, like junk? The strongest ones when it comes to buffs, like Blessing of Kings
on
spiders.
A shielded mini buff.
Yeah.
The real scary thing here, if you look in the long run, is RDU's turn 6 follow up as well, because these turns are all going to be fairly good for RDU. And then
the take that dragon
they're
back.
They're the core hound.
Oh, it's better.
It's better than Core Hound. It's got Death Rattle. Alright, so that will spawn back. Kip was like, alright, fine. Redemption.
I think it is fine. I mean, here I think you just, you can even heal. I think healing might be better than playing another Northshire. Even though it doesn't challenge the board as well, you really, really want your one creature to stick, and you kind of jeopardize that.
Yeah, the Northshire is more tempo, but Kibler, I feel he almost needs card draw in a little bit, because he doesn't have very many reactive cards. His hand all does the same more and more minions, but he is going for the tempo play.
I guess no matter what he does, he's going to have board presence, because the True Silver Champion wouldn't be able to answer it by itself. It would force him to use Blessing of Kings.
Alright, well, I think the Blessing of Might, True Silver is alright.
That rhymed.
This is actually a board clear for RDU if he decides to actually Blessing of Might and trade, but whatever you might is dead at that point, so a little bit awkward there.
Yeah, you basically get like a bad Abusive Sergeant.
Mm-hmm. Maybe he's gonna do another move, maybe something like
Noble
clear
Sack.
One and then play one of the secrets,
or perhaps you can clear one and then Competitive Spirit, because you might not get a much better result for it.
He might consider trading in the 1/1 here to play around Cabal Shadow Priest.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah. Ball Shadow Priest is coming up on.
Well, especially if you can do better straight.
I feel like he'll definitely, because if you trade the other one, then Cabal and you lose your whole board, so.
Alright, well, pretty manageable situation here for both these guys. I think the Mysterious Challenger, like you said, though, is going to be the hardest part to answer.
Yeah, and there is already going to be a Competitive Spirit this turn, so.
Well, don't you want to heal first?
Yeah, he does. He's going to do it. What's the best answer generally to Mysterious Challenge from Priest? Is it Shadow or Death? Is it Light Bomb?
That's interesting. I guess both would be fine. Something you want to do with either one of them is to proc the secrets first before deathing. If you get lucky, the Avenge hits the Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah.
You have to be careful though, because if you don't have any board control and you just open like Shadow or Death, the Mysterious Challenger, it comes back as a 6/1 because of redemption.
Yeah.
And if you can't deal last damage, it's still going to kill you, the 6/1, so you need to have some kind of board presence generally.
Alright, well, I like to actually save the True Silver Charge here.
There's only 2 secrets.
Yeah, but he's played so many, I think.
One of them should be Avenge, right? We haven't seen very many of them.
We also haven't seen the other Noble Sack. I think we know he has 2.
Yeah.
So I think it's just Avenge, Noble Sack.
Very likely Avenge, Noble Sack.
We've seen Redemption, and I guess he has omitted Repentance once again. He did that, I think, in his previous version.
Yeah. He's checking now. Yeah. Oh.
Repentance.
He only has 1 Noble Sack, or did we miss 1?
No, he definitely didn't have another one.
Okay. Yeah. Because if that was a Noble Sack, I feel maybe you can just leave up the big guy, and then hopefully just tax the Noble Sacrifice so it can't do anything that turn. There is the Cabal.
Interesting. Not too bad.
Yeah, that allows him to fight back on board a little bit. I mean, put out almost as many stats. Oh, never mind, just kidding.
Job's done. Alright, well, the Muster for Battle can answer that new creature pretty well.
Oh, wow.
Knife Juggler.
That's battle. Huge.
He can play out his entire hand if he really wants to.
Yeah, and then hopefully top deck with Divine Favor. Wow, Artie's actually thinking of trading for the cleric to make the juggles more efficient.
Well, the creature stayed alive, right?
Mm-hmm.
If a 6-6 didn't die this turn, it's not going to die next turn, most likely. Unless Light Bomb. Light Bomb would be really, really, really good for Kibler.
Yeah, Kibler needs his Light Bomb, or Chill Ball if he has it.
Oh.
Perfect juggles.
Three juggles, and now RDU can just Hero Power, and it's basically on that Light Bomb. Yeah,
this is where it gets really scary for Kibler, because, again, like we were talking earlier, where if you have a whole minion-based deck and you don't have enough reactive stuff, you might be stuck just dropping minions into like a board, which is probably the worst possible thing.
It's actually pretty close to lethal.
Yeah.
It's getting there.
6, 10, 13, 15, 14. Yeah.
The Balance Chosen not going to help here.
I think it's going to help. I think you put up a really big body and threatens a really devastating Holy Nova.
Is that much better than just playing the second body, though? I guess the problem with the two bodies is they don't trade for the Mysterious Challenger. But ultimately, it puts a very similar amount of health on board.
Yeah, it's a 6.
You can also use the Velens perhaps to get a better recovery with the Twilight Guardian next turn. So there is some value in just saving it.
Second Mysterious Challenge.
Yeah. There literally
no
can't be. There's no more secrets. There's no way there's two Repentance that the only one that triggered.
Yeah.
It is a 6-6.
Right.
Still. Which
for
is
six.
Pretty good.
Yeah. Would you play out the rest? I guess you're not. You have, if you play Noble Sacrifice on a full board.
Mm-hmm.
Does it trigger?
No,
but I think there's there's definitely going to be a trade into this Azure Drake, right? It's very scary to leave up an Azure Drake with 2 spell power.
Yeah.
He does know that there shouldn't be a Holy Nova, but there's always top deck potential. I'd say you can think about mighting a small guy and trading in, and just using it as a bad abusive sergeant here, just because you want to keep your other 6-6 alive or 6-5 alive.
Sure.
Okay, well, he is opting to do that. He still gets wiped out by Light Bomb, though. And he just saved Kibler a lot of health.
Oof. I mean, it's still an intimidating amount of power onto the board. 15.
15 for next turn, which is pretty much still threatening lethal.
Yeah, with the Knife Juggler 2 ability. That Twilight Guardian's going to have to do a lot.
There was...
Well, he got another Taunt Activator, which keeps him alive. So it's like one extra chance to draw Light Bomb. Yeah. And playing the Drake kind of gives you 2 extra chances to draw a Light Bomb.
Kibler had a chance.
Oh, hello.
He does have the Chill Mall.
Yeah. And he does have a dragon in his hand, the last Ysera sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
Second Juggler. Nah, I guess you just keep pushing them. It's
pretty much going to come down to this Chill Mall.
It's going to come down to the way he trades here, because if he doesn't kill the 4-4 Drake here, and he might not, I mean, I wouldn't blame if RDU just went face here, but if he does do that, then Chill Mall will wipe.
Oh my god, it's
that's
almost
so
lethal.
Much damage.
It's going to be at 1 life if he all faces here, but if RDU does all face, he's going to get wiped out by Chill Mall.
Okay.
Which is scary. What are those 2 secrets left?
One of them is Avenge. The other is Double Sacrifice.
That's not good enough.
Oh,
it is good enough.
It is if the juggle doesn't hit the
face.
Yeah,
juggle has to hit face.
Okay,
the 6 goes through.
2 chances for juggler
so
to hit face.
So juggle
doesn't
hit face.
So RDU wins 75% of the time here.
Yeah. And in RDU's perspective, if Kibler doesn't have a dragon, he does win no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
So it comes down to 2 pings on the face. No,
there
whoa!
It goes.
There it
okay.
Is.
Just one.
On the face.
Just one, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kibler's not happy.
Oh man, Kibler lost!
What? The second, Oh yeah, that's kind of weird.
Yeah. I wonder what Valley Town will do now.
Strategy has been foiled!
Yeah.
Touché!
Oh, Nylon does even it out. That is pretty nice. That's certainly a motivational booster. Certainly a tough matchup. I don't even know who's favored, but it does feel that the Paladin may have had a pretty tough time winning the game if things were under normal circumstances. But that Haunted Creeper double kings really messed things
awesome,
up.
That's pretty awesome, man.
Yeah,
it was cool to see a spider be able to get that big. And it's like, normally when you have double kings in your hand, you always anticipate it to be awkward, especially
right.
with a faster deck. But
in
that sequence of draws and the way it lies,
especially with
good.
The coin, so you have one on turn 3 and then
kings and kings.
Is that the Arena Dream Crypt?
Those are actually all cards except Redemption, of course, that you get in Arena.
Yeah.
So King's pretty good, but actually in Arena, the Seal Champion is usually more punishing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Vine Shield. I mean, it's kind of like Veil of Chosen, yeah, right? It's like really powerful onto the board, so.
Right.
We've seen that, and I guess we're going to see more of this. I wonder what the dynamic is like, because you can't just send Kibler again without risk of getting benched. But if Team Valuetown feels like Kibler's still really good, because Dragon Priest is decently favored across the field outside of Handlock, maybe he feels like a good spot.
Well, let's think about maybe what some of these decks might be. The Druid we kind of know, the Priest we exactly know. I think there's actually some chance Trump switches it up with Warlock. I think he actually had a lot of luck with the Dragonlock. So I don't know. I wouldn't put it past them to switch it up away from Zoo.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not 100% sure what kind of Warlock Trump is. I'm fairly sure Dog is still playing Patron, though. I feel like Patron is too good across the field in the sixth deck, or best of 11 conquests. Every team so far has brought Patron in the whole finals. It's like the Rogue that's
I think he would just bring his normal Rogue. Yeah. Dog is well known for his triple heal Rogue, where he likes to bring like two anti-Keel bots because he just hates Die Niagara. Yeah. And he plays like two oil, so you can make up for the lack of firepower with a lot of burst.
Do you think maybe the experiences Dog had with Patron Warrior might actually have some chance in him bringing a control warrior?
It does make sense. I mean, Patron Warrior is a very high skill cap deck. In a tournament this big, there's a lot of pressure, and it's very easy to mess up Patron, especially with all the I guess roping going on potentially. Yeah. And we even saw Life Coach last time kind of like not count the creepers, right? Had the weird smile. He knew he was maybe gonna mess it up, but
control really isn't that bad. Like control is still a fairly top tier deck. Most of the matchups that are good for Patron are still good for control.
I feel like one of the problems with control is that with the new Seeker Paladin being kind of good against control wear, since there's just too many threats followed by Divine Favor, it's like control wars generally fall out of favor, mostly just because of that one deck being really popular. So the one aggro deck where the control deck can't beat in a way. So
yeah,
we'll see. I mean, I like Dragon Warrior too. I think some people are experimenting with it, but I think Dragon Warrior is just worse than Control Warrior at the moment.
Not much worse.
Yeah, but still slightly worse.
I think so. Yeah. All right, well, we will find out what kind of Warlock Trump is bringing in. He's brought Zoo a lot of the last few times, but again, in the earlier stages in the tournament, as well as sometimes when he just plays alone on a stream, he does kind of spice it up a little bit with the Warlock sets, so I wouldn't put it past him here. In terms of favorable matchups, I don't think the Warlock is great against any Hunter or any Warlock you bring,
probably
really.
Probably not, yeah.
So Warlock Handlock
against Hunter is like a natural counter.
Yeah.
You hear power, and then they hear power themselves.
Yeah. Well, that is one way to see it.
Yeah, I guess trying to look at RDU's Hunter. Is he playing the hybrid version? He's playing Explosive Trap.
There's definitely an Explosive Trap. I guess you could count it as a face or a hybrid. The distinction is kind of weird. What counts as what kind of Hunter, but it's definitely something with Glaivezuka and Leper Gnome, something very aggressive.
I think it's more of the aggressive face hunter, which is
there's a high main though, so I guess it's
face hunter with high main.
Trump does spice it up though. We do see the Molten Giant and the Doctor Boom. Actually, I believe Demon Handlock cuts Doctor Boom a lot of the time. So I think this might actually lead into a likelihood of it being just pure Handlock.
Not something necessarily. It feels like they cut more of like the Sylvanas or the Siphon Soul type stuff from Handlock. Dr. Boom is just, like, too good. I mean, the reason why is, like, you can anticipate cutting Dr. Boom sometimes is, like, even if it's just BGH, it still has a big impact. Yeah. If it's your only BGH target, you can justify it. But in this case, you have so many things worth BGHing that Dr. Boom's not really that bad.
Yeah.
That's true.
In fact, like, at this point, Dr. Boom is more of a consideration, say, something like Patron, where the Boom Bots are sometimes liabilities.
A win condition.
Yeah, exactly. Instead of the whole BGH thing. There's two Arguses, which is not completely normal.
No, not at all. It's just because they don't. You know, Argus is sometimes pretty clunky, and for a long time people ran with only one, but it's very Life Coach-esque to run two Dark Defender of Argus.
Well, there's a Doom Guard, so it is probably very similar to what Life Coach was playing. Now, I've had a lot of success with Demon Handlock on ladder, but I feel like the Hunter matchup doesn't really seem much better than just regular Handlock, because I think one thing Demon Handlocks always drop compared to regular handlock is the Belcher, and that always gives you like a little bit of extra buffer.
Yeah, Belcher is a pretty common drop in the Demon Handlock, and that's it hurts, but you kind of make up for it somewhat with the Void Caller. Sometimes you get lucky and get out Mal'Ganis or Draxxus and then taunt up the Draxxus. Either way, it's not going to be a good matchup.
Really no Arcane Golem.
Wow.
Yeah.
He's just going to forego his curve.
Really important that RDU misses his 3 drop, and because...
Yeah, the Animal Companion is supposed to be able to just continue to be that damage point, because you expect your opponent to be able to play something on, like, this turn, maybe he coins something out, and the Animal Companion is supposed to dip twice in damage. Mm-hmm. Cuffer does 8, and Zamisha's sort of getting hit soon.
I really think he should be saving the coin for Jiraxxus at this stage in the game, because this is Face Hunter. You just need, like, volume healing.
Yeah. Both players not with a super good curve. Trump misses his coin Twilight Drake or coin.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Void Caller, so he misses his 4 drop as well.
It's more forgiving in handlock. Maybe not in this match though.
Yeah, he's getting very low. This is
already. He's basically at 10.
Yeah, if you count the Lepronome as like 4 here, and then Hero Power. Although probably Hero Power is not coming out here, but still, it's just. You don't really stabilize this handlock in this matchup very easily just because there's high main. So if Hunter's ahead and then they just slam high main on turn 6 and you don't really you don't really take over the board before then it becomes very hard to deal with the high main as well. So,
well, if you do put him under 10, there's actually the possibility, well, hypothetically in terms of RDU's standpoint, that Trump will be able to Molten, Healbot, and coin a Sun Fury.
Wow.
So that would be like completely game ending. So I think that's why he's not really willing to go full face right now.
Really surprising. Yeah, RDU actually trades. I didn't realize.
Didn't he get like his Hunter membership to the club?
Shamans can't.
Apparently, Hunters can trade, but Shamans can't trade.
Well, actually, weird one, game of playing. There was one game. There was one game that RDU did trade, which costed him too.
Even trading the Lepronome for free without killing.
Yeah, he's really respecting the health count because he can't deal with the Molten. So he really wants to burn first. And the double unleash is pretty awkward because you rather have just a direct burn instead of a situational
attack. I think RDU's reasoning is that he wants to set up the high main before going all in through the Moltens.
Yeah.
And if the Moltens come the turn before the high main, then the high main becomes very awkward to play. So...
So then, from Trump's perspective here, he's given some breathing room. He didn't have any taunt.
Maybe he's still saving the coin for Jiraxxus. Problem is, Trump's hand, there's not a really easy way from... Like, there's not a very obvious move that he has that just stands out that's very good. He doesn't have, a Belcher here. He doesn't have, say, like a Sun Fury or Argus for the Ancient Watchers.
I think he can actually tap again. I kind of like Ancient Watcher tap and trade for the Raptor. Because you might not even get attacked for 4. Mm-hmm.
He has to find him. Basically a move that's...
And you can silence the Watcher if you really want to control the board next turn. Okay, so a bit of a compromise play. He wants to develop the board a little bit more.
Yeah, he doesn't want to tap and put himself in a situation where he can't really back up that.
Mm-hmm.
And the BGH, what's it really going to drop on? Like, this kind of Hunter that has Explosive Trap and Arcane Golem, it's not going to run Dr. Boom.
Yeah.
Is it?
I'm pretty sure that with Arcane Golem and stuff... In Glaivezuka, there's no Dr. Boom, so the BGH does threaten the trade on the Shredder. With how RDU played, I'd be very surprised if he does anything except High Main, since the whole point
I like High Main trade.
Yeah.
So it's consistent with last turn.
Exactly. It's a very consistent line of play with how he traded last turn. So then if he High Main trades, he sets up for basically his next turn being start all face, right? Like, this is his last turn that he's willing to trade. He might just go face this turn. This is, like, the decision here.
Yeah, he's what, you know,
what
is
the, I guess he's thinking, what really happens if he leaves up the big game Hunter? You know, how does he get punished?
Mortal Coil.
Those kind of things.
I think it has to do with Hellfire Molten Talk.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a minion that's going to be problematic to remove outside of AoE.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can't Dark Bomb it.
Trump actually can't do anything again.
Well, and one of the issues with saving your coin for Jiraxxus, I don't know if Trump really tried to, it just ended up where he didn't have a great turn for coin, but Jiraxxus is really good for healing against like someone that's rushing you down, like a face hunter. But if your opponent still has the high main up, it's not, you know, it's you have to deal with the high main first before really playing Draenxus.
The only clean way to deal with the high main is Silence Coin Doomguard.
Yeah, you're gonna toss away some of these cards that are really good. Your heal bot.
Yeah, I think it might happen. Sometimes gotta do what you gotta do. I
wonder. Yeah.
Hope he doesn't lose his heal bot.
Oh my! It is happening.
Or his Draxus.
He must have pitched his Ancient Watcher.
Yeah, Ancient Watcher, and maybe the Dark
Bomb. He's like, are you kidding me?
Oh! Whoa. Wow! The perfect discard on this.
Wow.
Yeah, that's the perfect Doomguard.
Yeah,
that's a great pitch. Two cards I said.
But RD is still very good chance to win this game.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Now Unleashed the Hounds gets value.
A lot of damage on Unleashed the Hounds. Two Unleashed the Hounds, Quickshot, Arcane Golem. Problem is there is a heal bot. I feel like RDU might consider a line of play here where he just thinks about like the math.
He's got three cards, right?
Yeah, like whether he can
do it.
Yeah, whether you can kill him before Draxus, turn 9. And it's definitely possible. There's 3 turns for him to kill.
Yeah, and he's got as long as he keeps weaving in hero powers, he can continue to push his opponent down. And it's one of those scenarios, too, where he knows his opponent will want to trade onto the board.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, he can play Unleashed and doesn't have to worry about hitting into the 5-1, because the more minions he keeps out, the more dog they come out.
Hellfire is very expensive, too, to play here. I feel like you want to save Arcane Golem for the final
hit. Going for the double Unleashed. He does not want to give away a Mana Crystal.
This is the perfect move against Trump's hand. Right, because there's no AoE.
Right, yeah, exactly.
So it makes sense if he's trading as well, because if he's going to trade, then the second Unleash won't be as effective. So.
All right, well, Trump needs something here. That is
pretty much the worst draw loop.
He can bounce up to 19, and RDU can push for 7+7+2.
So 16?
Yeah. Actually, all right now.
This seems very close. I don't think that RDU will play the Arcane Golem if he can't have lethal, just because it pushes the Warlock into 9 mana.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
The Desperate Life Tap here.
Oh. Yeah, but that does allow him to potentially have.
Oh, he's at 1 right now.
Oh, he's at 1?
Yeah. Now he's
dead.
Now he's dead.
That does it.
He's dead.
Yeah.
Kill Command Arcane Golem. Quick shot.
And RDU stealing Kibler's role, cleaning up people with aggro decks.
Yeah, there it is. Very well done. And that's a very quick 2-0. RDU's done. He can take a break. Maybe that was a strategy. So yeah. RDU's got to be the one staying, putting up the long hours. And he's also, for the second series in a row, the first to finish up for Nolan.
Yeah,
not too bad. He's very happy.
I know RDU's been under probably a lot of stress with the whole Shaman
the lava fiasco. Burst issues.
Yeah.
I mean, he takes losses really hard.
Yeah.
I mean, you just look at he even takes upon himself to fend off the masses on Twitter to explain his plays. And it's like, that takes a lot of, bravery to say the least.
All right. Well, the Value Town conference area there.
Oh.
Back to the notes.
Yeah.
Okay, there we go. We don't want to show any super secret information.
Yeah,
there,
I guess. The Value Town security guards shut down that camera.
So. Yeah, they're pretty buffed up there. You don't want to mess with them.
Yeah, Trump only hires the best.
Now, as it happens, we started off the day with Value Town versus Nihilim continuation from last night, and Nihilim really felt, it was an unfair situation because the way things went down into a disconnect that they thought they won.
They
ended up losing, which led to Value Town getting essentially one step higher up in the finals. Maybe now this is what it takes, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe this is vindication.
They've climbed their way back. And the way the series started was 2-1 in favor of Value Town.
Mm-hmm.
And now Nihilim's up 2-1 over Value Town. So maybe they have the ones who can continue to win from this point. And also keep in mind that Trump just lost. So again, they're in a position where Trump has to be careful not to overextend and get benched, and then you can corner the rest of these decks here.
Yeah, I think it looks pretty well for Nihilim right now. It is still very early, and absolutely anything can happen, which is exactly what we've seen in the tournament so far, just the craziest stuff.
Yeah.
But, they do have that slight edge, and things are just looking up.
Yeah, with Dog also bringing a Rogue, if you look at some of the matchups left for Rogue, they might not all be so good either. Dog's, like, new Rogue. I know Rogue against Druid is fairly high, like, people are pretty... Not sure about which one's better, but...
It's just Patron, right? That's it. Rogue's all right against Patron.
I mean, depends on which kind of... If you ask a Rogue player, they're never disfavored against anything. They're always favored.
Okay.
Like, you talk to, like, Firebats, like, yeah, Rogue's favored in this matchup. It's like, yeah, Rogue's favored against Handlock. It's like, why? And the whole point is that they believe that they can hold on to things like Blade Flurry and build a big weapon, and then classes like Druid and Handlock can never build boards.
Yeah, it's a deck that a lot of the pros have a lot of love for. Mm-hmm. If you practice it a lot, it's a very high skill deck, and it's very flexible as well.
Careful throwing that word around, the S word.
Yeah, we saw what happened with Dr. Room earlier. I don't know if you should be really throwing... bullets around.
Don't just say those words lightly, Shrivecrow. Dex takes skill. Ooh.
That was just fired. Rolling dice for 150k today. I'm gonna roll in here.
You're fired.
I don't know about that.
Well, we have a pretty good opportunity here to see if Value Town can roll out this rogue eventually, but I still think the time isn't right at the moment. I'd be okay with just like tossing out Patron. It's still like a decent win rate. But the problem is the handlock. On both sides. You're always scared about that Patron running into the handlock.
The feeling I get from Dogring and Rogue is like it's kind of his like identity deck. Like he really just played that out so much and had such success with it, even at times where it wasn't really the best.
Yeah.
And I really get that parallel from Theis. I remember in the past when Druid wasn't really considered a very good class.
Yeah.
Theis just bring it anyway and just beat everyone. So
I mean, he was the only one, too. He still is. I mean, Druid's had middling results for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
You saw Dog struggle with it. You saw Hype struggle with it.
Right.
Strifecrow had to bring a different kind of Druid to succeed.
Yep.
Ty still was the one holding strong with Druid. Still drawing them wild growths. Still be able to hit those turn 3 booms.
Yep. That's a pretty nice advantage in any game.
It is. It is. All right, so Patron versus the Handlock. This is something that Lifewitch wanted to avoid, but... It almost feels like this is why you bring the handlock nowadays.
It's one of the main reasons.
It's so you can kill the patron.
Yeah, very, very strong against patrons. That's why you see a lot of the demon handlocks popular right now instead of handlocks. Because
it's even stronger.
It's very important to hit your 4-drop, like, high-threat minion.
Right.
And with the extra 2 void callers, you know, it's very unlikely that you miss. It's all about pressure in this matchup for handlock, just because with how powerful and high damage the handlock minions are, and Patron only having 2 executes, it really like makes it hard for the Patron to really like stall long enough for like the 50 damage falling combos that we always see.
Does Life Coach have the one shield slam variation of Patron? Because that kind of puts a little bit more removal in the arsenal.
I know Hyped had it. I don't know if Life Coach had it,
though. Yeah, I'm not sure whether he has it or not. Is this the first one? Okay, I don't think I saw Life Coach play it in the...
He did.
In the match.
I mean, you had to win with it.
Yeah. No, I mean play the Shield Slam.
I am almost certain that I saw Shield Slam.
Okay.
And I think that's what a lot of people are doing right now.
I think
just
so.
To counter the aggro decks.
I remember. I remember seeing
They're running the double Fiery War Axe, the double Shield Block, and the one Shield Slam just to counter some of the aggression. And some of that translates against Warlock fairly well. Less so the Fiery War Axes.
Yeah. Trump does have his most important card already. I mean, the Mountain Giant. I think he'll probably mulligan the 2 other cards and just try to pick up more threats here.
Yeah, it really doesn't seem like there is much point to keep a Watcher or Jiraxis there.
Yeah, wow. The second Mountain Giant. That's actually kind of the dream.
And a Dark Bomb to maybe prevent some draws from an Acolyte.
That's actually pretty much the dream, because what happens is you can play a... If you don't have a coin as Handlock, you can play a Mountain Giant on turn 4, and then on turn 5 you can tap, and then play the second Mountain Giant for 3 mana, so it's actually going to be... And because you get the weave in this extra tap, then you have like a really strong hand.
So the patrons are just not doing anything in this first turns anyway. So you have that room to tap and play whatever you want. Yeah. That's why it's such a contrast from the matchup that we just saw against the Hunter as Trump playing the
Handlock. Exactly. Like Mountain Giant is like the worst card against Hunter and the best card against patrons. So.
Right. Now, another pretty interesting thing is I feel like the Demon Handlock variety, whenever you get that Void Caller, whenever you hit it with a taunt, it's often so safe against patron combos if you have Mal'Ganis in hand.
They never quite know as well. So
right.
With how hard patron is and how easy it is to mess up. If you just give him that like one more X factor, and you know, it makes him like overthink, and you can
you just really mess with them.
Yeah, like, exactly.
Their calculations are off.
Exactly.
And at the same time, there's a patient ward, you don't respect it, and then Mel'Gans comes out and they.
Now, the slow game is ultimately won by the patron warrior still. If if both decks play out very slowly, the patron just has the nuts in the end. But Trump has those double mountain giants, as you said, and those are very high pressure cards. They're going to speed up the game. They're gonna drop some combo cards out of Life Coach's hand in some cases.
A lot of times this matchup comes down to how good of an answer warrior has to the first threats. We see Life Coach does have a slam execute for the first giant, and then also a shield slam. So if he can somehow stack up enough armor where he can shield slam down a patron,
yeah, that'll buy him time.
Two right now. He needs to build up four more armor.
Mm-hmm. He is a bit short.
Is it that valuable to save the coin for something too? Because you could coin out the Gnomish Inventor, give you board presence, and start the draws.
I guess I don't feel like the coin is super important in this matchup. If you can kill them, it's more about whether you hit the Emperor and whether you have the exact cards in your hand or not.
Sure.
It's generally not limited by that one coin in this matchup.
Right.
But it's just, I guess the cost of coining out a Gnomish Inventor is you're losing two armor for the Shield Slam. I guess it makes sense because ultimately with two armor, four armor, you're still not going to be able to Shield Slam down a Mountain Giant. Whereas if you get a Shield Block, then it might push you into the range of being able to kill it.
And 4 health is not really something a Warlock can deal with, so it helps a little bit, helps control the board a little bit.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's any additional aspect of it, like, you want to make sure that even though you keep your shield high enough to shield slam, you don't get too high, because that way Battle Rage can get some value.
Yeah.
Like, those are also like the hard questions
that
I'm never prepared to answer.
And Battle Rage absolutely is a very important card in this matchup, where all you're really doing is setting up the super combo.
Okay.
Slam is really good here. Yeah. It allows them Life Coach to cycle even further in their deck for those really important cards like Emperor and Shield Block here. People have, like, I guess, I think one of the main, like, evolutions of Patreon over the last, like, 3 or 4 months is that before in control matchups, Warriors used to keep the Frothings for OTK and the Patrons for board control. Like, that's how, like, most of the Patrons played. So they would just go ahead and, like, play Patron on turn 6 and try to use them for board control, maybe, like, you know, see if they have the AoE. But now, as Patron Warriors are getting better, it's this new style where it's even more heavy cycle with Shield Block. And the evolution of Patron is that they don't even play Patron anymore for board control. They actually save both Frothing and Grim Patron for their OTK. And that is what people, I guess, are complaining about in some sense, because that's really when you see Patron like kill someone through 211 health taunts and at 30, because when you have both the Warsong and the Frothing and the Patron, that's when they can get through all the taunts as well.
I know some people are like really livid in those moments. Yeah. They're already on Reddit with like, they got like the first half of the paragraph already typed
this
up.
It's already half written because the matchup just started. And they're
I can't believe he did 50 damage through two taunts.
Especially because, like, you know, Trump.
Trump is the one usually in the other. In the other person's
the receiving
shoes.
End, right?
Yeah. Well, again, he is in this position.
Yeah, that was a really good breakdown of Strife Crow, because like, I couldn't really exactly put in the words, but I think it's a really good point, because like, the whole point is that you use the pages to generate more damage, and you only need like one Frothing to break through.
Exactly.
They're usually like in the high teens or like mid-teens, maybe even 20 damage is reasonable for one Frothing to go through.
If you think about that combo...
Frothings have drooled way higher than that.
Yeah.
If you think about the combo, what happens is the taunt actually contributes zero, because anytime a patron bumps into a taunt, your Frothing is getting +2, and since the patron is only 3 damage to face, you're only losing 1 damage. But if you count the fact that you have an extra taunt on the board for the whirlwind that's inevitable that turn as well, you're actually like, any taunt is realistically not there. It's like, it's not there. Right?
It's actually hurting you.
Yeah, if there's two whirlwinds, it's hurting you.
Yeah.
So
taunt creatures increasing your face damage intake. Why do these
working as
exist?
Intended.
Yeah. Well, I think it's still pretty fun. I certainly enjoy the crazy moments that happen as a result of patron combos, and I honestly would not be upset at all if it happened again here.
Well, there's a lot of plays available to Trump this turn.
This is a hard turn. A lot of options.
I like just Hellfire. I don't know if you really need to silence the card draw. Yeah, it's only one card, right?
Very good here because, one, he has the Shadow Flame for the patrons if they come out, and two, the Hellfire clears the whole board, right? The
Ghoul kills the 2/4.
Kills the 2/3, and the Acolyte actually dies in one shot because of the Hellfire.
Yeah, I'm not really liking the Emperor. It feels like a lot of room for disaster with your opponent can draw a lot of cards.
The disaster is when you go face and play Emperor, or when you trade, the Battle Rage is actually the scariest.
I know in some situations, Acolyte draws a card from overkill damage. Would this be one of those situations?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either, but I've seen some craziness. Yeah. Looks like he's probably going to opt for just the Dark Bomb.
Huh.
But because he signs first...
He wants to save the Hellfire for a patron turn. He thinks Life Coach is capable of just flooding the board with patrons, but I really doubt we're going to see that from him.
Yeah, it's fair. You know, having Hellfire just as more AoE is one of those things, the same as the patron might feel against the big threats. Like, don't use the Execute and Chosen unless you have to.
In a way, with the new style of, like, Grim Patron being used for, only the OTK, where they're not even trying it, it's, like, you kind of even okay to just not have an AoE just because they won't go for the patron anyways sometimes, so.
That's true. But then, is it ever, like, one of those scenarios where you're, because they use the AoE, you're more incentivized to go patron flood?
That would be perfect because you have the Shadow Flame.
Okay, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
All right, well, you can clean up with a Shield Slam, but you can't really do much else in this position.
Yeah, the question is if you Cycler Slam here, you Armor Up here, or you Cycler your Battle Rage here, there's a lot of weird things.
I kind of like the Armor Up. It just might buy you another turn in the end, which is exactly... I mean, you only need one turn to finish the game, so one turn can make a really big difference.
Life Coach has two Whirlwinds, Inner Rage, and the Patron. So once he does pick up the Ember and the Frothing, one of them, and the War Song, you can almost guarantee that...
Few more pieces. Few more pieces. Trump has a lot more pieces than Life Coach does, but Trump is not playing a deck that he just wins instantly. So he's gotta grind out his opponent.
He has to just slam down his cards.
But that can actually start to happen because Life Coach really doesn't have any more removal. So right now it's Trump's game. Trump is on the clock to win the game, to seal out the game before Life Coach can draw more combo pieces.
Wow, with this Deathbite, Life Coach doesn't even really need Emperor, I think. There's so much damage already that once he picks up the War Song, it feels like Trump would be dead. Mm-hmm. I feel like the big turning point of this game right now is how big this Battle Rage in Life Coach's hand can get. Because if Life Coach somehow managed to set up a really nice Battle Rage, he should get what he needs. I feel like the problem is it's very hard for him to do that, though.
Yeah, you pretty much have to use half a patron combo and then Battle Rage to cycle through the deck.
And that's one of the problems you were saying with the armor being at 7. If Life Coach is at 29 here, the Battle Rage drawing 2 cards is perfect.
Well, then what's the play here? Set it up. You can kill the Emperor. It's pretty important to kill it, too, because you get too many tempo plays with it.
If Life Coach had one less armor, he could Inner Rage.
Yep, and draw that extra card.
Inner Rage
Death Spite. It wouldn't even be that bad.
Yeah, I think it'd be great if he had the one.
That's pretty funny.
Oh, he drew after he played the weapon.
Misplay. I'll be Twitch chat.
Oh, how he missed you.
Yeah.
Well, in this case, Trump...
Trump has a big hand.
Yeah, he's got a full hand.
Discounted as well.
Yeah, he can do a lot of stuff, but are you really willing to do much of any of stuff?
He can play half his hand.
It feels like all the cards are reactionary, and they don't really fit the situation yet.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe just slam down Mal'Ganis is okay.
Yeah, I feel like it's pretty reasonable. I mean, you can set up a Taunt Wall with the two Watchers. The problem is that Taunt Wall doesn't pressure the Patron.
Yeah.
And if they do go for the super combo, the Taunt Wall won't actually even help that much.
The really cool thing with just dropping down Mal'Ganis and not having another creature on the board is Deathbite literally has to attack Mal'Ganis.
Yeah.
And that, again, that helps you grind out your opponent, which is how you win.
Yeah. How many cards does Trump have? He has 10.
So he has to play
something. He can't even tap.
No, he cannot tap.
And then try to play
he could play Watcher tap and then evaluate. But I think Mal'Ganis, like you said, might be a strongest option.
Play here.
Yeah, it kind of alleviates the X factor, as you called it, from some of the Voidwalker plays that Trump might have. But it's still the best play.
Life Coach is out of hard removal, right? With the two executes.
Did he use both? I thought he used one
execute. I thought he used one shield slam, one execute.
One shield slam, one execute.
He used two slams, though. Okay. So it's not like he could cycle into slam and then kill this off.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose his best chance to do this is to first draw off the shield block.
Yeah. Life Coach has a couple turns, right? It might even be more than a couple. Like, Trump won't actually be able to get lethal on Life Coach, say, three more turns, even without removal. Yeah. So
Life Coach's draw has been punished, though. Like, he really hasn't gone through that many cards. The chance of him drawing a piece that he needs is not particularly high, as it might otherwise be against other matchups.
And it's actually very awkward to start using your Inner Rages and Whirlwinds for card draw if you get something like an Acolyte of Pain or a Battle Rage. It's hard to actually utilize your damage as well. So just gonna try to survive as long as he can. No real answers for the Mel'Ganis. I guess his answer is just tanking it for a while until he gets what he needs.
It's still no rush. I mean, outside of Mel'Ganis, what can you really do to
the Dr. Boom? Damage?
Yeah, the Dr. Boom. It's pretty good.
Pretty good.
Mm. Would you consider taunting up something else besides Mel'Ganis so that way he can't directly attack into it? Or does it not matter at all?
Again, I kind of like... I like Sun Fury into Dr. Boom right now.
Protect the Boom.
No, just require the weapon hit to do 9 damage to the warrior.
Yeah, yeah, so taunt up... oh, okay, so you're saying not protect the Boom, but force him to attack into Mel'Ganis.
Yep.
I feel like Trump is very scared of playing Dr. Boom. I can't imagine if he's going to play Dr. Boom with this line.
Yeah, because his opponent passed with a lot of
damage. Yeah, so he did. He saw you pass. I guess he's scared of getting OTK'd because of the extra minions on board. I've seen. That's why you see Trump actually getting all these positions on Reddit, because Trump plays in a way where he does. You know, Trump doesn't go
gives
for
him
it.
The time.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. He just kind of doesn't play.
Ten
health. We just did the math. That 10 health is actually 0 health worth of protection.
Yes.
Against the combo.
Yes.
Oh.
Oh. Okay. So there's the last execute.
But no war song to be found.
No. And no emperor either.
So with this, you probably just execute Mel'Ganis to slow down the damage intake.
How do you hurt the Mel'Ganis right now?
I think you have to use your weapon. You have enough activators in your hand here.
You have one whirlwind as well.
Yeah, but it also deals with the Ancient Watcher, which is really nice.
I mean, Ancient Watcher is not really much.
Oh, yeah, you're right. You're not pushing for face damage anyway, right? Because you're not getting through the taunt anyway, and Ancient Watcher doesn't attack.
It kind of helps to have it around. It's damage.
You're something that Life Coach might do is just bump in the Armorsmith into the Twilight Drake and execute that. That way he gets to save all his Whirlwinds. As far as the actual life gain goes, he is going to have to kill Mel'Ganis when he... Life Coach is gonna have to kill Mel'Ganis eventually if he wants to kill Trump, but the Twilight Drake has 4 or has 10 health, so it's like technically a little bit more efficient to just.
It is, but you don't have your win condition right now. You want to slow down the game.
I guess it's a difference of 5 damage still per turn with the 9 compared to the 4.
Well, he's gotta make a decision now.
Yeah.
He looks like he's gonna whirlwind execute. I can understand that too. Just like the immunity effect also lets him life tap too much without being in danger of potentially dying.
Yeah.
So Trump only has 6 damage on board now every turn.
It's a net of 4. It's not even that much.
Yeah. Cut in half. Or more.
Just out of curiosity, is Jiraxxus ever really played in here outside of Voidcaller stuff?
I don't believe so.
Mm. But he's great with Voidcaller.
Yeah. If you can get him out with Bloodcaller, taunt him up.
If you think 10 health on a Twilight Drake resulting in 0 protection is good,
well,
wait until Jiraxxus gets 14 and shows you that.
Both have been executed, though.
Yeah.
So
once you get enough health, it becomes protection.
Yeah.
Because if the patrons can't actually kill the minion with taunt, then it becomes protection if the Frothing has to trade into it.
What is Trump trying to draw into here? I feel like he has all the big stuff. He should just be playing big stuff once a turn here.
Yeah, the way Trump's playing his most important resource is time, like turn-based.
Right.
Because his minions are just doing that damage every
right.
turn.
It feels like
I don't feel like he's drawing
most,
into anything. It's just
it.
He's just trying to get the turn damage.
Maybe it's just a race. Who can draw more cards? It's a tie right now. 11 left.
Maybe he's trying to figure out, like, Voidcaller so he can pull Jiraxxus, and then...
The reason I like Dr. Boom is like every time I play it, it just kills either Grim Patron or the War Song. I'm just so happy.
Yeah. Oh, the Emperor.
Emperor on this hand is pretty nice.
Pretty nice. Okay, so I feel like this is coming down to whether because Life Coach is running out of time. He's going to die very soon at this point. Trump like actually just went all in as well. So I feel like the most likely move for Life Coach is just plop down the Emperor and hope to top deck Warsong next turn. I haven't done the math, but I feel like if the Warsong comes down next turn, it's lethal.
Oh, you're right. Well, I mean,
you have to Enrage, so you can Warsong, Frothing, Patron, Enrage.
Yeah. Assuming he doesn't kill the Frothing.
Exactly. I think with an Owl and Lucky Bombs, Trump has Lethal.
Wow, interesting.
Because he can Owl the Watcher for 4 more, and he has Dark Bomb and Hellfire to activate the Boom Bots that might hopefully go face. And that creates space for the Owl.
Wow, 33 21. Damage.
He has 21 damage if you count the Watcher as 4 damage as well.
Okay.
There's 33, so he needs to do 12 more from hand.
Just 6 up, so the Boom Bots can hit for 6. Yeah.
Yep. That's reasonable.
He has a potential lethal Owl if he decides to go for it.
Mm-hmm. I feel like that's very likely. Unlikely.
Because
you actually kill yourself with Hellfire. And then
but it is pretty spectacular.
Yeah, it's spectacular. I can't imagine you just like Hellfire. If you miss, you just lose. Yeah.
If I was streaming, I would think about it. Mm-hmm. Seems good.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things, too, where you realize every turn you give to the patron is one more chance you give them.
Exactly. But unfortunately, there's no Owl, so I don't think
it's. You also have to think you're pretty dead right now if you're Trump. Like, he's been saving 5 cards the whole game, and he just Emperored them.
You know, Life Coach has been running very bad in his Warrior. In particular, most of his just games. This one problem he always has. Never has the Warsong.
Right.
Maybe he doesn't have Warsong in his deck.
Uh-oh.
Maybe someone trolled him.
Yeah.
Have we even seen one, though? Warsong from his deck. We haven't Maybe seen one. No, yeah, we had to have. He won a game, right? You can't win games without Warsong.
No, he had a Warsong, he just didn't play it.
Oh, okay.
Against Eloise.
Just a patron Zerg. Yeah. That's right. I remember now.
More taunts coming right up.
Literally just like impossible wall of taunts.
Yeah. This might be so many taunts that it's
like literally
impossible.
That Boombot was the old Sun Fairy protector from the beta. Do you remember? Like give every
minute. Oh, what a piece of crap.
It would have been like a spectacular battle here.
Yeah, it would have been a lot of crazy stuff.
If there was a Warsong.
Spectacular battle.
I am honestly not sure what happens, right? But it would be awesome to see what the fireworks.
The Battle of Plano.
Yeah.
Remembered in 2015.
Taunts versus...
I think there's literally no way Life Coach stays alive.
Okay, so let's count Trump's damage. 11, 12, plus 6, 18 damage.
18, but from the hand, he's got Hellfire.
And Dark Bomb.
And Dark Bomb, so that's 24.
Yeah. This game's.
And the Boombot would trigger, right?
Yeah.
Boombot would trigger, so 20.
Unless Life Coach decides to use his board to clear, which I don't think he even can. There's no Warsong, so the minions don't clear anyways, I guess.
He can clear the 3 health creature, just the Argus. It's not enough. Yeah, he just loses here. No. There's absolutely no way to survive this.
He is definitely dead.
Wow, that's so weird. There's not going to be a Reddit post after this game.
You never know. Maybe there's going to be a post with the opposite way, asking for Patron to be buffed.
I just thought Trump survived against Life Coach's Warrior.
How can I interact with my opponent's health pool if there's too many taunts?
Yeah. That seems like a reasonable problem.
There's a lack of interaction in this game.
All right, well, that is pretty dominant for Nihilim. I think they're up 3-1 now. And isn't Trump benched?
Yes.
That's a big deal.
Life Coach won, and Trump's been benched, which means Dog or Kibble have to play, which leaves him Warrior, Rogue, or Priest. And that's not exactly a very versatile lineup.
Yeah, well, we'll have to, well, the Warrior, if it's Patron, it can't win against anything. The Rogue... well, the confidence you said can win over anything. The priest, I think, is just a versatile deck overall. I just don't think they're that punished by being benched in this situation.
I mean, it is one thing that it's
makes sense.
Okay.
Oh, I think there are 3 cups of OJ for Crypt.
Numbers are wrong there. Oh wait, no, numbers are right.
I'm taking Nostromo.
Wait.
15 seconds.
Trump just won.
Oh yeah, he did.
Oh, what are you talking about?
I was just missing the OJ. You fell for it.
Okay, you guys are confusing me because I thought the score was wrong, so it was 3-1 based on what we were talking about, and then turns out that Trump won.
I'm AFK.
Okay. I'm better now.
Okay. I'm just kind of drinking orange juice here.
All right, so it's 2-2, totally evened up, no benches, Trump's happy.
Yep.
And we all suck at casting.
Oh, except Strife Girl. Uh-huh.
Is it? Oh, yeah,
I called it out, so. I actually, like, mitigate myself from the blame here.
Oof. I feel pretty good after that. All right, well, Trump won with the handlock.
Mm-hmm.
So, Life Coach.
Life Coach is the one
he's
threatening
the
bench.
Of being benched, yeah.
All right.
I guess now that your opponent's handlock's out of the way, what deck gets more freed up because of it?
I think
Patron, right?
Patron, yeah. I guess Life Coach plays Patron.
Yeah. But, I mean, anything can happen.
And if you anticipate that, then Dog should play Rogue here.
Does Rogue beat Patron, though?
If you ask a Rogue player, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
but if you ask a Rogue player, it beats everything.
Yeah, but like, okay.
I really think on a realistic, legitimately yeah. think they can beat Patron.
Rogues
it's very close.
It.
I mm-hmm. feel like it's very close. I'm actually not sure what the official stats say.
It has to be close to 50,
we're
going
to have to get the monk stats.
Yeah.
I'll text them right now.
Okay.
Oh, really?
Sure.
All right. But, yeah, it feels like the Rogue, especially if you're running weapon-heavy stuff with Blade Flurries, the Patrons, they can't really pull off the flood-the-board garbage that they can against so many of the other aggressive decks.
It basically comes down to a Patron playing a control warrior against Rogue, because
right.
Rogue has a very limited amount of minions, mm-hmm. so... And with the new Patrons playing the shield, the double shield blocks or even single shield block, I've talked to a lot of the patron specialists, and they say that in this matchup, it's definitely possible to play like a control warrior and just kill every
armor.
Single minion mm-hmm. that Rogue plays, since mm-hmm. Rogue is very minion light.
Yeah,
and then
but
just
I think
out.
They've been favoring the Shredders mm-hmm. more often still.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
still like more consistent because, of course, the Violet Teacher tokens, yeah. it is their way to win with damage, but it's
yeah.
their way to lose with frothing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think the Violet Teachers might be out. Like, I talked about not facing Rogue like ever on ladder. Mm-hmm. I don't even remember the last like mm-hmm. Violet Teacher Rogue. Then
the
last few
is,
probably were like Shredder
I mean,
ones.
The Rogue is actually like the Violet Teacher tokens is actually how you fight back against a lot of the Paladins.
Exactly,
mm-hmm.
exactly.
Which is like
say.
So the weird
yeah,
catch 22.
Because the Paladin is also a really
right.
common deck, and the Shredder is the one that's the bad four drop in that
mm-hmm.
matchup. Whereas
mm-hmm.
the Shredder is the good four drop against
yeah.
the Warrior. So
yeah,
yeah it's like hard. That maybe that's why Rogue isn't super helpful on ladder because
it's
you actually
too
have
polarized.
To make that. You have to make that decision. There's
mm-hmm.
no way that's.
I thought the Ooh. I really thought the Rogue was coming in for some reason, but instead we have Patron Warrior versus Freeze Mage.
All right,
another fatigue game, boys.
Well, the last time Tice attempted this, it did not work out in his favor.
Looks
he was
like we're in for a long game.
He was around one full health pool away from killing his opponent.
Yeah, I think he got his opponent down to like 45 HP.
And I think you actually. Almost need the coin to beat the Patron Warrior
yeah,
as a Freeze Mage.
Yeah, fireball.
Yeah,
he coined the Scientist to try to get the early damage in and make up for that fireball,
yeah.
but he didn't end up doing it.
And maybe it's like one more fireball there.
yeah,
80 life. Ultimately, that was not. That's not the. That
yeah.
wasn't going to
yeah.
be a break point on the, our last.
Like you're in denial if you thought that that was a difference. Like, but it does help a lot.
Yeah.
I guess so.
Yeah, this matchup comes down to Patron also being able to play like this new control warrior style.
Poor Tice. He's queued up like the Freeze
control
Mage the
twice.
First time in new series and hits the Patron Warrior.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make sure that happens again in your series if
yeah.
it gets that far.
And that's one of the weaknesses of Freeze Mage. It's a deck with very bad matchups.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of okay matchups.
Yeah.
So
I mean, it's also got some pretty good matches against the aggro, if you can anticipate it. According to Crip, it doesn't lose against Secrets Paladin.
According to Crip.
According
but
to Crip.
He doesn't know anything.
I cite you as my primary source, 2015.
Yeah. I've never lost it.
Yeah.
I play like 10 games, that counts.
Yeah. I mean, you are completely valid to speak your opinion as if it is fact.
Yep.
On the internet.
Yep.
You play 10 games.
And we're still on the internet.
That's right.
All right, well, I kind of wonder if Tice will try to play us differently, if he'll just play no card draw.
Yeah, that's really interesting because the Freeze Mage is so reliant on having, like, Thorsen hit a bunch
yeah.
of minions, but a bunch of spells,
mm-hmm.
So that way you can not only deal with the minions but burn. But if you're not drawing cards, you're never going to get to that point.
Exactly,
mm-hmm.
exactly. What the Patron, like, Patron Warrior's card draw is very flexible in Battle Rage, so... What you are technically supposed to do as a warrior is to kind of match their draw. If they draw a lot, you kind of keep up so you can, you know, control their
yeah.
super combos with Emperor. If they don't draw a lot, you kind of don't draw a lot either. So I guess that's what it comes down to. Tice does decide to just play the block instead of Acolyte, but that's because he wants to Acolyte ping next turn. So
mm-hmm. it's okay. I mean, ultimately, It's more the onus on the patron to just not draw cards than you to not draw cards, because that's just part of your win condition.
Yeah.
But the patron has to be the one delicately making sure that they're drawing cards to keep up in parity, but then also make sure they don't overdraw.
Exactly. But if they are able to manage that line, it becomes pretty hard for the Freeze Mage, since
the armor. It's hardy hard super for the armor Freeze combo. Mage.
Yeah, especially if you can get the Ember before the armor combo.
Look how much damage that is. That's insane.
Yeah, he's got two war songs.
I feel like if you do enough damage in one attack, you should just punch through Ice Block. You know?
Like, there's like a
if you do, like 30 in one attack. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is actually a really interesting hand, because normally you play this matchup like not really worrying about Frothings and the damage, you just out-fatigue them. But with this hand, like, say Dog doesn't play this Frothing here, and he just plays Emperor next turn with Warsong, two Frothings, and some Whirlwinds, I wonder if you can just, like, kill Ties randomly.
Probably. I think someone said that the most damage that you can do with Warsong, two Frothings, and, like, yeah, and like a Dread Corsair. Back when Dread Corsair, and you can like push the limit without killing, probably was like 42 damage.
Okay.
So like, if you could get that all in one, then yeah, you can.
And with patrons, it's much more though.
Yeah, with patrons, it's more.
You need some interaction. You need,
like,
usually,
you need, like, unstable goals to be able to bump into stuff and implode.
Well, maybe not. You could have, like, two shield whirlwinds. Slams on your unstable ghouls.
Yeah, that's true.
We could just have two whirlwinds.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. Two whirlwinds plus the death. Well, no, Deathbite would kill you too.
It killed Frothing.
Yeah.
That would be the
over. Three whirlwinds is fine. You just can't have four whirlwinds.
Yeah. Well, the three whirlwinds plus the unstable ghoul kills.
Oh, there's no ghoul on top of
it. Oh, okay. Yeah. Right. So you're saying unstable ghoul would be the part
of it. Okay.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that's gonna be...
Like, Tice can't even reach Fatigue in this one.
Yeah, he might just be dead, because there's... Flamestrike is very awkward. You can't just leave up a 5-1 Emperor. You can.
No, then... but he can Blizzard Ice Lance. Mm-hmm. But that gives up his damage, so that way you can't reach... But this is not a game that... This is not a game that's gonna be about reach damage.
This is not a game about winning, about actually. Surviving. It's not even about winning.
It's about whether or not Ice Block can actually stop a Frothing Berserker. We're about to see it scientifically.
Yeah.
Blizzard Ice Line is interesting, because it allows Tice to both freeze the Frothing so he doesn't die to it and kill the Emperor.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That seems like that's like probably going to be what happens here.
No, it's probably going to do cheesy Frost Doomsayer.
That also makes sense.
He is able to play double Doomsayer, which makes it very hard to kill.
That's actually really interesting, because there's almost no way that Warrior will actually make the ultimate sacrifice and blow all the executes on the Doomsayers.
He basically has to combo the Doomsayers or have double executes.
Yeah, exactly. Because, you usually are very careful with executes in this matchup. One of the ways is that you lose is you burn all your executes on Doomsayers, and then you can't answer the Archmage.
If you Deathspite Overwrite, Battle Rage for 4, and then attack with the next Deathspite to prepare for super combo. Is that just 2 all
you
in?
You don't
at this
even
point?
Want to draw that much cards, I think. 4 cards. You mean play both Deathspites this turn?
Yeah.
Whirlwind. But I think that's too big of a battle.
It's just
rage
2 all in?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I feel like you just let this board go and just play the armor game from here on.
I do like hitting with the Deathspite this turn to set it up, but I guess. It's still really one of those games where you don't mind taking your time. Yeah. Also, that's a really good Emperor Thor's name. Just drew 2 unstable
ones.
And a Grim Patron.
He even has a 0-cost slam.
Yeah.
For that sick. For that extra unstable ghoul.
Extra unstable ghoul damage and AoE. Yeah.
I think if Tice just plays his obvious play here, Emperor,
he dies.
At least the block is gone, probably.
Right, he doesn't actually die.
Yeah.
Oh, we haven't empirically.
Because Dog doesn't have Hype's hand with the whole double armor smith mass armor gain, but he does have the damage hand. Like the double Google plus War Song Frothing patron hand. So.
Does Ice Spirit keep him alive?
Yeah. Without the minion to bump the ghouls in, it's not that much damage.
But he can slam his own.
Yeah. It's still probably around 30 something.
But he doesn't have Deathbite Whirlwind either.
Mm-hmm.
That's gonna be.
He doesn't need it. He has 3 Whirlwinds right now.
I feel like Dog should just not play these ghouls and just wait for a minion to be played.
So he has Ghoul. Maybe just...
Except Deathbite here, attack face.
He has ghoul, mm-hmm. slam a ghoul, and then whirlwind. It'll trigger both ghouls for three whirlwinds.
And there's four minions on board. So that's 2, 6, 10, 11.
There's no way you're getting enough damage without playing the patron.
19 damage. Yeah, I think he's right. He's enough mana to do it.
Without the actual patron as well.
I only count 90 damage max, and I think that's like pushing the limits. Yeah.
I wonder why Dog is playing this ghoul here. Like, I can't feel it contributing very much. It's a one mana ghoul, very easy to play from your hand.
I think he just feels it's not threatening enough to get killed.
Okay. Makes sense.
Is it because he can't play his full hand next turn?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
4, 5, 6, 7.
He can.
Oh, that's something that he also is afraid of too. If his opponent has Alexstrasza next turn and starts going aggressive.
Alexstrasza another body.
Yeah, so once Tice plays a minion here,
one whether creature.
It's a body, it's very resilient. Yeah.
Whether it's Emperor or it's Alexstrasza, Doug should be able to suicide all the ghouls very easily. He even has a free execute. It's a free no, but
no.
He can execute whatever.
It's a whopping like, one.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't really played Patron enough to know exact breakpoints, what all the damage is. I know actually some players play Patron enough where they actually just know in their head like how much damage this is.
Yeah,
just, exactly. So
with enough practice, you just remember all
but
this stuff.
But it's pretty... I feel like Ty's going to lose his block here.
He can, but is that really relevant? Does that really lead to the win? I feel like you just control the board until fatigue. You might even do like a defensive combo. There's just no need to play this. Like, you're at... It basically, you are at 40 life if you just use your hero power.
If you burn all your Armorsmith.
Huh. Okay, so now he can play Patron with his Frothing Berserkers.
He can do that like 30 life gain.
Yeah,
maybe now he can do both, kill them and get 40 armor. Who knows? Because now you have the Armorsmith with your combos.
Hold on. Oh. Okay. So. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 minions on board. So every whirlwind's 6 damage. If he gets 2 whirlwinds off, 3, then that's 18 damage.
That's like 20 armor.
But then patrons copy once, twice, four times.
So yeah, like an extra. It's about 22 armor, maybe.
He can play. Dog has enough mana to play Warsong, Frothing, Patron, Armorsmith, Ghoul. And have the ghoul on board. And that seems like a lot of damage and a lot of armor. Mm-hmm. Whatever it is, it's a lot of both.
He definitely has like round...
There's no way to play Warsong now. You have no time
there's
now.
There's a rope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Okay, he had like 30 damage, I think. But the thing is, it's supposed to be like 31. So, like, I just like estimated... Because here's the problem. Because the patrons might actually just get a cap of how many times it spawns.
Mm-hmm.
And you might not have enough board presence.
Yeah.
Are the stats in?
Monk says Rogue is favored 52%.
Oh!
So that's pretty much a 50-50.
Yeah, look at 52. That.
It's won 34 games and lost 32 times.
Alexstrasza is coming down.
The moment that this Alexstrasza goes offensive, Dog really doesn't feel bad about going all in. Because one of the problems is if you went all in, then the block Alex defensive healed.
And he could have Alexed and blocked
in some cases. He definitely had the ice block pop last turn.
I feel like it.
Because the patrons can each attack. I didn't even count that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, of course. Like, yeah, way over.
No, that's what I mean. Like, the patrons all attack. And if you roll in enough, then even the ones that die, the other ones...
I was counting just pure frothing damage. No,
that's what I was wondering why you're even counting. Yeah. Because it doesn't even feel that close to me.
Yeah.
The patrons attack.
Okay. Well,
so this is the super turn.
This is Tice's depression turn.
Yeah.
He's going to need some medication after
this. Is like the lethal while getting 40 armor turn. Oh, it's not quite going to be 40 armor, but maybe like 20.
Yeah, probably like 20 armor. It'll definitely be a blowout. The armor spell, I mean, one more could he have one? Could Tice have won if Dog didn't have the armor spell? I mean, he did draw Frost.
Nah, he still needed a lot more.
He doesn't have Archmage yet either.
Not,
there's
not,
only
not
15
maybe.
Damage in the hand.
He had,
no,
he had only
more.
Like 23 health.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. There's a lot of damage in the hand.
Dog's roping on the patron right now. He's doing the correct plays right now. He started at the start, so he's playing perfectly. But playing perfectly may not be enough.
Yeah, he actually just has to go for it and hope that he has enough.
Did he miss the...
Wait, what?
Some attacks?
Stop blocking the view, execute. Yeah, he had enough. Whoa, this, god.
Did it proc? Oh, damn it, it proc. I thought maybe that was the punch through, you know?
Okay, so everything worked out fine. Dog could have played a tiny bit better in the sense that he could have gotten down one, but that's not a big deal. Also, he technically didn't have to execute the Alexstrasza, which might actually end up hurting him a lot because there's... Well, he has another execute, I guess. You do need that execute for Antonitis, which he has one, so I guess it doesn't matter.
The Flame Strike plus the Heal Bot?
He can actually freeze everything and clear the board. He has to ping one of the patrons, Frostbolt the other one.
Isn't it better?
And then Blizzard.
But I think it's better just to Flame Strike and Heal Bot here.
The problem is you need to heal here, right? Because you died to the weapon.
Okay. I missed the Flame Strike. You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
It's only because the cost reduced. Normally, this is way too expensive.
I wonder if Tyus can actually somehow win the control game, but with the execute.
Yeah, the second execute is pretty big. He got rid of. That's like the key. You save the two executes for the big threats that if you go unanswered, you can win.
This game might still go on for quite a bit, actually.
Yeah, it's only got 41.
Yeah. Dog does have enough burn though.
Freeze mage either that fast. Patron will eventually win by just armoring up enough.
Yeah,
but it'll
he has Warsong and Patron and 10 cards, and right now he has a lot of turns. He can answer the Archmage. Dog is facepalming, but I don't think you really. Oh, that what? I think 3 damage a turn is just fine right now.
Ultimately, it'll go okay because as long as you can somehow still kill the Archmage, which you can with Whirlwind Execute or just even attacking it.
I think you should just wait. Damage. Like the only threatening card this game is the Archmage.
Yeah,
and you should like just wait until that's
maybe
played.
Maybe missing some experience in the matchup. Seems like from his facial expressions, he's like having some, like not so happy moments. But he should still feel confident in this game.
Yeah.
By just keep arming up, and he knows that he's already killed Alex, and he knows he's already killed Emperor. So realistically, all he has to do is kill the Archmage. You know what? But with the whole Emperor for Tice, how many fireballs does this Archmage get? Three?
He gets 3 fireballs, but the thing is, Tice doesn't have to do it. He can, like, double fireball now with the Mad Scientist and Ping, and just, like, start forcing it out of his opponent.
Is there any way where that's enough damage with the 3 extra fireballs? That's 18 more damage.
I think you want to just go now because there's a lower chance of executing
there.
There's
some chance
there's no weapon developed.
Exactly. We do know there's a Whirlwind execute.
There's just some chance that Antonitis sticks.
Yeah. Does Tice still have the Blood Mage? Because with all these cheap spells, the Blood Mage can threaten, I think, 3 extra damage. Blood Mage plus 3 fireballs in the same turn.
Yeah, maybe.
It might actually be enough damage. Let's see, there's 5 fireballs, 5 times 6 is 30.
And it's supposed to be 29. But there's armor. Second armor spell.
Wow, this game is actually really close. If Tyrus has the Pyroblast, which he doesn't, I think.
Are you sure?
His whole deck.
It's Hyped has the Pyroblast, I believe.
Or is that Hyped?
Hyped had the Power Blast.
I think Tyce actually
So what did Tyce have? Double loot order?
Yeah, Tyce has double loot order and heal bot. He actually doesn't have Power Blast in his deck, unfortunately. The Power Blast, if he had Power Blast, he actually might have had enough.
Okay, so he doesn't want the armor smith just to get destroyed here.
Yeah.
It's worth more than one armor, and that's fine. Eventually he will draw into Patron and Warsong.
I feel like this is all of Tyce damage. Like,
yeah, but he also has like the Mad Scientist, which might be really relevant if he can get that to just attack a couple times.
There's a Fireworks, though.
Yeah.
So one time.
You're right.
Once.
Yeah, once.
Zero time. Because
which,
it's attacked into.
Attacked into.
It's important that he even draws the second dice block, too.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't want to just die from the hand, right? So the Mad Scientist is important. I think it's also important that he's just hero powering every turn. So if you're playing Scientist.
There's no point just dumping all your fireballs. You should at least be able to hero powers.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes more sense to play the Mad Scientist, hero power, and then just play all the fireballs.
Also, the Mad Scientist actually pulls out the block, which might be useful.
Yeah, the ice
it might give him another turn against patrons.
Maybe save your cheap fireballs in case you get Blood Mage.
But what would that do?
Doesn't
you Frostbolt twice?
So then you just fireball once and hero power then.
Fireball once and hero power maybe?
No, he's dropping double, I believe.
Loses like 1 damage in a long, long run, kind of, but it's faster,
right.
So.
The fiery war axe here will chop it down.
How many damage is 3 fireballs? 18 damage. 19.
Yeah.
If he armors up, oh wow, there's almost lethal here. He's one off lethal if you count the two blood mage damage.
But the armorsmith.
Yeah, okay, slow. Okay.
Yeah, so he's still a little bit off.
This is actually a very close game, and the funny thing is if Tyus actually had the Pyroblast, he would probably actually win this game. Because enough damage.
Yeah. Dog is like calculating if he can get away with hitting the mad scientist.
Or enraging
it.
He's only got six cards. He doesn't want to draw too much.
Can we see like a card count?
He's at four.
He's gonna pull ice block here.
What about the warrior?
Six. Warrior has two more cards in his deck. But some of those cards really suck. And he has Acolyte in play, actually, which is relevant.
You're right.
Oh, but so then, if you start pinging it, maybe you win the fatigue. So we know that Tyus does not have any more Doomsayers. He did the double Doomsayer. Right. So the Frosto Doomsayer won't happen. He does have a Blizzard, though, and a Cone of Cold. I think a Cone of Gold.
Do you want to kill the Armorsmith now so it can't get a lot of value if you have the Blizzard and stuff?
He only has one card. I don't think it's really threatening that much.
Ultimately, you'll get more damage by trying to draw to fatigue out the Warrior, maybe to try to ping the Arch, to ping the Acolyte.
Ping the Acolyte.
So I guess you Frostbolt
the Armorsmith, and then you ping the Acolyte, maybe. And then you just Fireball the face one time. That's reasonable. I mean, now that's Dog's. Is he planning a second shield block?
A lot of the warriors have been. I don't imagine Dog has been too creative to play a new deck like
although
this.
Although the interesting is shield block doesn't actually give you more armor if you're in fatigue.
No, no.
Yeah.
That's not helpful at all.
Because you shield block, you get 5 armor, right. But then you start fatiguing faster. Yeah, yeah. So I'm not sure how that works.
Well, one thing that he can do is try to set his opponent to 1 HP.
And then
because he doesn't have heal bot and he doesn't have
Tyus is completely out of healing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Alex Strauss and Healbot are gone.
So
is there a barrier left?
Yeah.
Oh, Blood Mage does also draw you the card.
The barriers have been used.
Okay.
So the Blood Mage ping the Acolyte and then you double Fireball the face?
You have no more direct damage past it, so I think you just do it.
Can Dog get lethal somehow here?
But can... Patron, oh, yeah.
That's lethal.
That is enough.
To proc the block.
Right. But that's good enough because there's no more healing. There's no more blocks. There's no more damage prevention.
Well, wait. If you proc the block at 3 and then say...
I think he just maybe clear you.
What?
Just like freeze or maybe he has a good blizzard depending on
exactly.
How
it turns. Yeah, he freeze, has a blizzard. If Dog loses... If Tyus loses his block at 3 life and then he just blizzards, then how does Dog really deal the last 3 damage?
Oh, he ends up just passing. He doesn't want to draw an additional card to get to fatigue.
Wants to save it for burst.
I think this.
Is Dog gonna get lethal here?
Yeah, I think this slowdown.
Yeah, he's waiting for the.
This slowdown makes it so Tyus can't really win. I think he's shaking his head. He realized Tyus has no more win condition.
Yeah, Tyus maybe should have even done the Blood Mage last turn just to develop the body or something. Oh, but he died even faster.
No. Yeah.
Looks like Dog will win this game on the ice block turn, on the fatigue turn.
Right.
Yeah, this is it. Last card.
Oh, yeah.
That is a pack. Last card. Yeah.
So his goal is to do nothing. He can't win.
Yeah, he literally can't win.
There's actually like no way to win.
If both players disconnect, the game would actually award Dog with the win.
Yeah, because he has lethal.
Right, the fatigue. Basically. The fatigue would tick faster.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that wraps up the game here, and Valuetown takes a much-needed victory here to take the series edge 3-2.
And what a relief for Dog. You can tell, like, he's doing all right with Patron today for sure. I think he's actually maybe 2-1 with the deck.
Yeah.
But I think he's still feeling yesterday's pressure rounds with that deck. So every time this deck wins is a huge relief. You can see it in him.
All right, well, that means Tyus he's down, right? RDU and Blade Coach are still the only ones remaining here. Mm-hmm. RDU was relieved. Just trying to like remember what's happening here because the series.
Yeah, well, let's take a look at the decks and matchup here. So Tyus just lost with his mage.
That's an important win for Valuetown because they get the
they get that triple check mark.
First class.
That's true. We have Druid, Priest, and Rogue. Still a pretty big question mark on the Rogue, but...
I like the Rogue.
I kind of share the confidence a bit. I was doubting it a little bit, but the Patron Warrior is still there. It can win against that. Yeah. I think it can It can do okay against the Handlock and the Druid. The Freeze Mage, I think, maybe a little bit tougher.
Druid's actually pretty good here, too, because Handlock and Freeze Mage are two good matchups. And then Druid versus Druid is, at worst, even. And then the Patron Warrior is reasonable.
Yeah.
So I think the Druid here from Trump is what you can expect.
Druid should pick up a win at some point fairly easily.
Yeah.
It seems like all the decks can, like, all their lineups are fairly close where, like, any deck can win any matchup.
Right.
It's just who picks up the wins first, kind of. I guess there's not a deck that stands out here that's, like, unwinnable for any matchup. I guess the biggest problem is the Priest. Because Priest is bad against Handlock, probably bad against Patron Warrior, not super good. Dragon Priest is a lot better than the old Priest against Patron Warrior.
I think it's actually all right against Patron Warrior.
It should be all right, but still probably not super favored. Priest against Mage, Freeze Mage is very bad, I feel. The Dragon Priest, just because you can't really clear the Doomsayers.
That's true.
Pain and Vulgin.
We've seen some pretty close matches, though, but I think you're right. I think the Freeze Mage does have the edge. But I think the Druid matchup actually might be Priest-favored, because the Druid just can't catch up from those huge boards.
Depends on Innervate, I feel.
Yeah, but you can't even grind them out. You really need Innervate.
If you get the Innervate, you just, I guess, like, snowball early.
Right.
That's what it comes down to, probably.
Right, right. Yeah.
So I guess it still seems probably the hardest deck here to pick up a win eventually is Kibler's Priest here. It's kind of weird because Kibler's been just crushing everyone, so he'll most likely pull it through at some point.
I still feel that the Freeze Mage has a pretty tough time as well. It's not great against the Priest, and I think it's actually kind of bad against the Rogue and the Druid, especially because the Rogue has two heal dots.
I guess that's probably the Nihilum's, like, weak point as well. Oh. Yeah.
Here we go! Mage. Here we go! Rogue versus Handlock. We get to see who has the edge.
I actually think it's probably Warlock favored, just because it's a Demon Handlock and not a regular Handlock, because Mal'Ganis invalidates a lot of lethals.
Yeah.
Especially coming from a Voidcaller.
Yeah, it can be the case for sure. And there's just a lot of threats that you still have to deal with. Like, you don't, as a Demon Handlock, you don't lose any of that edge of the big threats that Rogue has to spend three cards removing.
Yeah.
And you're still able to keep it up. Like, turn four threats are a big problem. But the Rogue, I mean, he's already seen Life Coach's deck in its entirety. He knows that there's no, like, Acidic Swamp Ooze to watch out for.
Yeah. I mean, the way it works is, like, Rogue usually can build, like, Rogue usually doesn't really want to sap, like, the first minion that comes out. Like, they're more important later. And that's, like, the extra punch Void Caller gives you.
I bet he plays all four.
Yeah.
I think he plays two teachers, two
probably.
Treasures,
seems to
then,
be the case.
Two Geobots. What he could be cutting is a one Farseer and then, like one fan. Although, with the prevalence of Paladins, I generally like two fans and Rogues nowadays. Just because you want to kill those Musters that much more. It's, like, super dire.
Yeah.
It's really Voidcaller that's
really
hard in this matchup.
There really isn't that much room in the Rogue deck, though, if you want to play all those cool weapon combos and stuff. He has to be missing something, right?
Yeah, I mean, generally the flexible spots are, like, if you're playing three drops besides the SI7 agents, like the Farseer, for example.
Yeah.
How many four drops you have? How many five drops, honestly, too? Because some people ran, like, Harrison or Slugbelt.
Even, like, Phantom Knives sometimes.
Yeah,
Phantom
Knives is a cut. I personally don't like cutting Phantom because of Paladin.
Yeah.
It's like,
well, there's a sap. Yeah. I feel like whenever you see Rogue win against Handlock, it's saving saps or just having a monstrous weapon that just nothing needs to be sapped.
Sometimes both. And, like, saps don't do anything by themselves, but when you get a teacher behind them, or even, you know, even Shredder just, like, hitting face every turn, it's like, those things are just super scary. One fan, one Farseer, so nothing out of the ordinary.
This deck might have 35 cards.
It could, realistically. And if he plays Burgle, it actually does.
Oh, wow.
That's actually the perfect draw for Life Coach.
Yeah.
Because now he has two 4-drops where he can coin one out. You don't really want to coin out Voidcaller and then play your second Voidcaller because then you don't have any demons. Rogue can actually, like, usually kill the first 4-drop that comes out with things like Eviscerate and Backstab.
Yeah.
That's why the Voidcaller is so scary, because you can't really kill the Voidcaller just because you don't really know what will happen.
You could sap that target, but you're generally right.
If you sap it, though, it doesn't really, like, any 4-drop can get sapped, so.
The clock begins, basically. This is the stage of the game where the Warlock starts punching face.
Yeah.
Right.
And I feel like Rogue wins the late game if Rogue can, like,
get there because Blade Flurry is so strong. They can play around Molten's very easily with all the bursts. It's just ultimately it comes down to how well Rogue deals the first four drops.
Okay. I generally don't like playing Teacher up against the Twilight Drake. There's a lot of ways for it to get answered, and you know that Teacher is one of the main win opportunities to win. So I think the Shredder is like the most important thing here.
Shredder actually trades pretty well the four drops as well. They don't trade very well into the Shredder, I guess, is what I'm going to say.
No, they don't trade. Nothing. What trades well into Shredder? Sludge Belcher?
Oh, they're Shredders.
Flamin. Yeah, that's right.
Abusive Dudes is really the best.
Sure. Explosive Sheep.
Mm-hmm. I wonder what Life Coach is really thinking about. I mean, he really just wants the Dark Bomb, you think? I feel like you just have to play this aggressively as the Warlock.
Just play the Ward Color out?
Yeah, I think you play the creature and start grinding.
Go face or start trading? Probably face. Start trading.
No, you don't care if that trades against you and you're threatening more damage.
It's very scary to leave out Rogue minions. Ultimately, you want to clear them eventually.
This early, though? Like with 5 mana, yeah. How much damage could you really take?
Well, it builds up.
You take a lot. Alright, Mech Warper, pretty average in terms of the expected result here.
Yeah.
Alright, defensive play from Life Coach.
Okay. Drake is... It's good. Just keep up the flow of cards. Like, one thing that Rogue often does is that it expands its hands so much to try to gain board control that it often uses 2 cards, maybe even 3, to remove.
Yeah.
And then you just have no cards. So having the Drake keep up the amount of cards in your hand is great. Having Sprint as a backup is also good. He's going to definitely need to benefit off of a prep soon, though, because prep is going to help him get back in.
I feel like Dog has this game under control, actually, because I actually really don't like Life Coach's turn 4 where he tap and Dark Bomb. I feel like you really need to push out the second minion. Yeah. Like, if you look at it from this position on, it does feel like Dog can kind of drag this game out into, like, the late game where, like, the prep oil blade flurries start really becoming active. Just because he didn't get that extra minion on a turn that it really mattered. It feels very.
And
it feels too
mill.
Close now.
There we go.
Yeah. I feel like, yeah,
what are we gonna lose?
Really dislike that move.
Yeah, I mean, this is kind of what you do. The sap is to help leverage.
Oh, wow.
Not a bad card to lose.
Yeah, those are what I like to call Blade Flurry fodder.
Well, I mean, that was just Shadow Flame target if you wanted to use it, but it's not the best. Well, I guess here you can
play
Mortal
again
Coil.
If you want. Yeah.
Yeah, Mortal Coil first, I suppose, if you want to see the draw.
Maybe you Mortal Coil the 3-5.
Yep.
Oh, I think you definitely Mortal Coil the 3-5.
That's pretty scary.
If you want to play around Sap, I guess you could hit with the first Mortal Coil, but you just don't want to draw, see what happens here.
It makes. Well, I don't know. What makes the most sense? You almost really even want to play Emperor here. Just because you'll be able to dump your hand really quickly.
Oh, yeah. Emperor's
but it feels
a
so bad.
Play.
It's really scary. Yeah.
It's a viable.
You have
play.
AoE. Maybe you do it.
Well, yeah, you have the AoE, and if he does have like an oil combo, it's not that likely to even land on a creature that can attack because of the Vile Teacher.
Okay. We've got to go quickly. Void Caller. That's interesting.
I think he really wants that. Lord Jiraxxus to trigger. Mm-hmm. He thinks the saps are gone, and he thinks if he can taunt up Lord Jiraxxus, he's going to save a ton of health.
The second sap is really important for Dog now. Like, he can't just throw it out willy-nilly just because he feels like he wants to get board control.
Yeah.
In fact, what's the best way to deal with this?
There's no dealing with it.
Maybe you won't, maybe you will.
Wow. I was not anticipating that.
All right, dealt with.
Yeah, he showed that Void Caller who's boss. You're gonna step in my board. Gonna whack you with my wicked knife.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's really looking quite well here for Life.
Yeah, of course. It's just like we expect some kind of big dramatic thing, and it's like, nope, I'll just tap it.
It's really nice when someone trades their Void Caller on their turn, so then you have your turn to deal with what comes out. It feels really awkward to kill on your turn and then you have to kill something else.
But it feels scary though at the same time because then they get to control the outcome better.
That's why the card is so good, I guess. It's like either way. This is actually really good because you can't Hellfire. Like, if it's a 3-4, what you can do is Hellfire and then trade in.
Yeah.
But because it's a 3-3, you have to trade in then Hellfire, but then whatever comes out gets hurt.
Yeah, that I think that was the primary motivation as well. Very smart play. It's a very intelligent play.
Very, very good play.
Okay. Which puts the Drax at a 3-12 instead of a 3. Mm-hmm. You know.
Oh, there's another Void Caller. We don't even know what which one would happen.
No, it's the Drax. Yep, so it's a 3-12 instead. Mm-hmm. Good counter from Life Coach to recognize that he'd actually have
two. Wow, that's a really tricky play regarding cards.
The sequencing was good. Yeah. Alright, so
you don't want to sap that Draxus right now.
Yeah, but you can eviscerate the mountain giant.
Ultimately Draxus isn't gonna kill you that fast.
Yeah, so you can just leave it on the board.
Deal with the mountain giant, which you can eviscerate with the Drake. Ultimate Dog is just trying to cycle through his deck until he gets the perfect combination of burst cards. Pretty much like
which is seen none of.
Yeah.
He's absolutely none of prep oil.
Mm. Blade Flurry and maybe ideally the Charger, the 2-1 Charger, right. Sassy deck hand, which would be perfect.
As if he's playing it, though.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the decks just have to play it these days. Mm-hmm. It just provides so much more reach if you can't put a creature down on the board.
Okay. The Sprint is also going to be really useful, but the Draxus can get taunted now.
Basically, Dog needs a turn where Life Coach doesn't have like a high damage minion. Unfortunately, it looks for him that turn won't ever happen.
This is going to be a defender play, right?
Yeah. It's going to be the case where if Dog has to sap Drax, probably didn't even do that. He might even sap the Voidcaller. But like you have to do 9 health worth of damage to Draxus.
Maybe he sprints here finally. His hand's not looking very good.
It's true. I mean, he's also at 27, and he's not being threatened very much with that board. He needs to develop, like, a huge board clear to actually take care of this.
But he's drawn most of his minions. He's about to hit all of his weapon buffs and his preps.
That's in a way, that's good for him to draw those cards, but then he's still very far behind tempo-wise and board.
It's so weird. Like, if that was any other, like, big taunt, you'd basically want to, like, get rid of Draxus by sap and then kill the Voidcaller, but if you do that, you know it's coming back.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think maybe you can take the opportunity to re-dagger here, but the problem is you still don't have your weapon stuff, so maybe it's better to play Thanos so you can draw.
Has Dog gotten any preps yet? I feel like preps is zero super preps. Important.
No oils.
Zero preps, zero weapon buffs at all.
He needs a cheat on his mana, basically.
I mean, he has backstab. That's one way to sort of cheat, but that's about it. I think Thanos, there's a case for Thanos, even though it is spell power, just because you haven't hit some of those really important cards.
It might just be too important to keep for spell power, just because he's like the fan, the flurry, the backstab. So he might be just setting up for a board clear next turn and then trying to draw a little bit later into the oil combo for lethal.
Wow.
That's good. A very good follow-up to the
Voidcaller.
It's the second best card he could have drawn.
10. Mal'Ganis being the first.
Yeah. Well, those are the only two demons left in the deck.
Yeah.
How scary does this position look from my coach's perspective? If it's not scary, probably just play the Dr. Boom and go for it.
It's like you're holding so many cards.
Yeah, exactly. But there's a lot of taunts, which is
Dr. Boom is also pretty good because if it's behind taunts, like the little Boombot guys, often how you die is a big Blade Flurry and an oiled Charger.
Yeah.
And the Boombots might just kill the Charger.
Exactly. We'll see what he decides to do. It ultimately depends how safe he feels here, whether he. It's gonna, I guess.
Yeah, Boom is the best threat too, because the Flurry will end up making the Boom bots hit back.
Yeah. I feel like
and it can even kill whatever Charger.
I feel like one really major card I haven't seen in this Demon Handlock is Lotheb.
It's gone from the deck. I feel.
You think
too,
so?
Too much stuff. Yeah.
I feel it really helps some of the matchups because you don't die to burst.
Is this a board clear? I think it is. So like you play Thanos, backstab the Dr. Boom, you dagger. You Phantom Knives first. Oh, wait, the Phantom Knives, if it hits the Thanos...
Yeah, it might kill.
I think it is, yeah. It still is. No, it's not. Drax might survive.
The prep.
So this has to dodge the Thanos twice.
Ooh, double fours, too.
Oh, wait, no, now he has prep. He can actually just SI the last remaining thing.
Man, you played Rogue a lot.
Well, it's actually the deck that I'm playing.
Yeah.
So he can.
Yeah, he can deadly poison prep yeah. Fury and then
leave up a SI. Doomguard yeah. Basically, because he can deadly poison attack
yep.
Flurry, mm-hmm. You, then use the SI to kill the Draxus.
Correct, but he has to prep first.
Yeah,
he might. He has to go quick.
I feel like it's too late.
Oh, he's shredded.
Uh oh.
That's a mistake.
Uh oh. Yeah, I think he might have played Shredder instead.
Oh, he just
literally. Yeah, he missed. He missed because you know this is what happens a lot. You end up playing so fast that the cards shift, and this happens. And Dog went too slow, unfortunately.
No, he didn't even attack with so.
He didn't attack with a weapon.
He didn't even attack with a weapon, so he wasn't even trying to play.
Oh, okay, you're right.
That's SI, yeah.
So he was really hoping that his opponent had no demon then.
Right. Gonna hope I think that's talent. A reasonable assumption.
It's reasonable because if he attacks here, he has to play that side, kill it. But if mm-hmm. he doesn't, he gets to play Shredder.
Fair enough.
There's no point attacking it, yeah. Taking more face damage, I guess, if you don't get to clear it.
Well,
Dog's actually not dead.
No, but he could have been. Like, he could have been if he four damage is absolutely it's realistic.
It's basically Mal'Ganis. Yeah. Instead of the Doomguard, you lose.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's true.
And if Dog actually attacked the Draxus before Flurry, he would have died unless he played this side as well.
Right. Mm. He's really hoping that if he gets oil on the second run here, on the last draw, he might be able to turn around on board. Mm-hmm.
Do you think Life Coach will pressure here with, or heal? Looks like he's healing. He feels far enough ahead.
What do you think the pressure play is? Just the giant?
Probably the Drake and then the Thorzin, which mm-hmm. is a stronger body still.
Okay.
I feel like maybe the giant and then the Drake would have been a little bit more just because it's more health on the board and you only need to push for four more in a lot of cases.
Bowling Guard Lieutenant. So he saps the Drake, oh, tries to buy some time.
Why not sap the demon?
Doomguard? Yeah. It just comes down for damage next turn. Doesn't it?
Discards a lot of stuff though.
But I think he's dead by doing that.
Oh, is he just dead?
12 damage on probably the dead. Board. There'd be 7 damage on
the board. Oh yeah, you're right. He would just die. He would just die.
5, 8, still 4 off. And there's multiple minions on the board now, so maybe just Shadow Flame.
Yeah, I feel like this is a really great.
Seems Shadow like a Flame. Really clean one.
Yeah.
He needs a Shadow Flame for 3, so the Healbot's an easy Shadow Flame here.
Yep. And that should seal it. I don't
there's
know.
There's only one prep left, there's just not enough mana to do stuff here. Maybe a Healbot will buy you another turn. Maybe you can prep Sprint into a Healbot.
Yeah, there's just not enough. Wait. How much health did Dog have left? 4?
I think
4.
So.
Oh, okay, so he couldn't even take the Twilight Drake hit. Because if he did, he actually had a board clear there too. He weapon up Oil Flurry SI, yeah. And then he could clear. But the problem is that he didn't actually have a follow-up. So, tough stuff, but that's kind of the way Rogue can go. And I think Life Coach made it very complicated for Dog to get some good turns as well.
It really felt like Life Coach kind of played defensively the whole game, but in the end it panned out just fine because Dog wasn't able to draw any of the finishers while the defensive plays were happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that.
It's full control.
And one of the things is like maybe Dog doesn't even have the Sassy deck hand with all the cards we saw. You're joking about the 35 card deck.
Mm-hmm.
And Sassy deck hand's a major reason why the matchup is not as bad as it seems in the first place.
For so sure.
If you do cut the Sassy deck hand, it could just be a very bad matchup against Handlock at that point. So
alright, well it is 3-3, it is tied up.
Halfway point, boys.
No, it's more than halfway because they can't go 6-6.
Okay.
Well, this all right. So halfway, we just passed the halfway.
We point. Just passed the halfway point.
Yep. You feeling it, Strife?
I'm tired.
You're tired.
Yeah.
You need to swap in.
Yeah.
Have Ecop or Kalento swap in.
Yeah. Yeah. Here at the Archon House, we get like free food.
As well, huh?
We get like free food, so people overindulge.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the ultimate.
That's how they
strategy.
Get
be wary if anybody from Nilum or Valleytown offer you some In-N-Out Burger, Stripe Girl.
Okay.
They poisoned it.
I don't know about that, but yeah. You don't want too many of those.
Can always go on the fruit diet to prep up for the game.
The crypt diet?
Fruit and veggies.
So like literally what they do here at the ATLC is like, Crypt, we didn't know what to get you, so we got you fruit. They give them like a big bowl of pineapples and strawberries and stuff. Yeah, it was alright.
Yeah, it's alright.
Yeah. The strawberries aren't the best, but it was alright. But, you know.
Well, they're not from California.
No, the California stuff's good.
Yeah. All right, well, as far as the game goes, Life Coach gets a win for this team. Pretty good stuff. The bench rule doesn't really apply much because Valleytown has that nice triple check mark, even if Dog wants to play Rogue again. It really doesn't matter if he loses at all.
Mm-hmm. And now that the hardest matchup is out of the way for Rogue, maybe that queues up. At the same time, Hamlock escaping from Druid is not that big of a deal either. But say, like, Dog goes up against Freeze Mage here, and then he loses, and then Druid's all of a sudden lost its advantage.
That's true.
So I would be comfortable
you
with
the kind, yeah, you, it is a lot based on that. You're right for identifying it. I think the Rogue is okay. I think probably the only matchup that has less than 50% is the Freeze Mage. It's still close to 50, but... I think it's slightly less than the other two. Yeah. You're really looking for that.
Yeah, and I think this is the anticipation that they wanted for Druid versus Druid.
Oh man, Trump versus Dice, the Master Druider.
Can Trump out-Druid the Druid Master?
Can he draw Wild Growth before Dice can draw Wild Growth?
Well, to be honest, you know, sometimes it's not even Wild Growth, it's Innervate. Innervate gives you the tempo early
on. Yeah, Druids really like that removal, so it often does have the same effect. Against some other decks, it often has a punishing effect.
But Dice has Wild Growth.
Told you. Best Druid.
Trump?
Nope.
No, and you know what? Tice also has Darnassus Aspirant, and he also has a slower Druid deck, too. He's got the Ancient of War, which Trump might not have. This is the first time we're seeing Trump's Druid, though.
Yeah. Ancient of War is pretty good in the mirror. Loses to Dr. Boom pretty badly, but other than that,
I think there's some chance you just keep all of that.
Most cards lose to Dr. Boom pretty badly.
Do you consider keeping the Ancient of War here?
No.
You need heavy cards if you're going to keep double ramp.
Yeah, but I feel like it's even better to go for Ancient Lord to fill your hand back up.
Just try for something playable sooner.
Yeah.
Their Nessus Aspirant's not guaranteed ramp either. It's more of a forced response.
That's true. Opponent. It's very hard to hold your Aspirant until turn 7. Yeah, it's like it helps you ramp for your like 4s and 5s, so probably not 7. So.
You usually have Aspirant as like a way to force your opponent to Wrath it and miss his mana, and then you can capitalize on other things too.
And drop the Wrath. Was Tice the one who dropped the Wrath the last time as well?
Wrath doesn't really do much.
Wrath is generally a bad card in Druid Mirror. Now that
kills the Aspirant, though.
It's a little bit new, but he had his own Aspirant, so maybe he could just hear power or something.
Okay. And now that Tice does have 5 drop, there is merit to coining out a ramp here.
Yeah, he's definitely going to coin a ramp. He's thinking which one. I would go for the Aspirant. Even if it gets Wrath, you can just Wild Growth.
You can Wild Growth.
So it doesn't really hurt you. If you coin out the Wild Growth, there's no point, right? Because you have 3 mana extra and you're still playing an Aspirant.
Right. So, and you don't have that flexibility.
You might as well just play your minion first, I feel.
You missed the damage.
Yeah,
you just don't have that flexibility to counter your opponent's Aspirant either.
Yeah.
I don't know. It feels like both times Thais had the Wrath opener and both times you kind of got punished by it. Like, it would have been good to have a Wrath here so he wouldn't lose his Aspirant right off the bat. He actually punished Trump's hand big time.
You can still do the same.
Well, Trump's the one that is slower. Oh!
Hey, oh,
look at that.
I like people downstairs.
No, the Aspirant's still better, isn't it?
Yeah, the Aspirant's better because it challenges the other Aspirant.
Is it? I like the Wild Growth because, I mean, you can't kill your opponent's Aspirant, so you can't really deny this Mana Crystal.
Yeah, but if your opponent, like, you don't really want to be playing Keeper of the Grove anyways, just, like, as a 4. You want it to be able to, if you have to, you can use it for board, but generally speaking, if you play the Aspirant and it ramps successfully, like your opponent doesn't hero power, then you can play your 4 to gain the board. If he does, and you can still Wild Growth and hit your 5.
Yeah, it triggers a hero power response or a Wrath from the opponent.
Yeah.
That's everything. But then if he has that, you're not in a good spot. Like if
that's fair.
So I think I like the Wild Growth better.
Yeah, I guess the problem right now is then you're not really contesting Tide's Aspirant, and Tide still has something good to
do.
So
he Wild Growth twice.
He's going to 5 next turn. Yeah. And then he's putting up Druid of the Claw to protect it.
Yep.
Unless Trump gets the Wrath, then he
what
can
play. What is Tice thinking about? There's one card with a green glow, and it's a really good one.
I can't imagine you'd hero power here. I can't comprehend.
Oh man,
that would be the most. Maybe he's faking his opponent out, like making him think that he has a Shade versus a Wild Growth.
He could just be role-playing as Life Coach.
Okay,
now I think this hesitation is to mess with Trump a little bit. Because Trump is a player to read into these things.
Yeah.
And if he's like, okay, I have a Shade as one of my cards, or, you know, that kind of thing.
Shredder, very good pickup. Probably the best card I could draw on this turn. Other than Wrath, maybe, I'm not sure.
I think Wrath might have also been
Wrath would have been better if you consider the hands, just because there's nothing Tyus could have done if he lost the mana. But
yeah. Well, the Keeper's going to come down and kind of challenge this board, I believe. Like, do you really want to keep going with this mana lead on your opponent?
And Azure Drake is also fills out the curve.
Yeah.
And you can, like, you can Force Nature next turn if you need to, or you can use Keeper.
Mm. It looks like I would play Azure Drake.
That's kind of true. Azure Drake does work with the Force.
Just because if you kill an Aspirant here, like, say you sign some trade, the Tai still has 5 mana. Druids have a lot of good 5s and 7s, but not a lot of good 6-drop minions. So I think what you can do here is play Azure Drake and next turn fill up your curve with Aspirant and Keeper, and on that turn kill Tyson's Aspirant, yeah. So that way you lock out the 7 draw.
I like that. I think it's really good to really play with his mana crystal.
Yeah. Because next turn you still have the Keeper, or you can Force Nature. You have 2 options, but it should allow you to kill an Aspirant before Tyus gets the 7.
Mm-hmm. And the
Swipe might make it a bit easier to do that too.
Yeah. The Adjudic provokes a response as well. So Tyus will trade into that and hit. That leaves. It's a pretty good Force of Nature. It's like a really sick Force of Nature.
Yeah.
Honestly.
This is actually good. Yeah, perfect Force of Nature. Yeah. You have to kill the Drake, because if you don't, then swipe, right?
So, yeah, swipe just butchers you.
Yeah, so looks like that will happen. Force of Nature seems way too good compared to Keeper.
Well, you can swipe here if you want to save Force of Nature.
Oh, that's true. Swipe actually does the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, you take 4 damage.
Almost the exact same thing. I guess you take 3 damage because your hero powering.
It's true. I don't think the 3 damage is really that consequential.
And it's pretty important to have Force of Nature for Savage War later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a good one. And now the 7. The
ramp is down.
Yeah, this is super important because turn. Oh, okay, well.
Nice
top deck.
Is it?
Oh, but it's not even that good.
Yeah, it's not. You need to kill that creature.
Yeah.
This might be a turn if you have the Living Roots, maybe. Yeah.
Unfortunately, you still play Drake here. If you get Innervate, you're lucky. Otherwise, you still play. Wow, he's going for the Valley game.
Interesting. But the thing is, something still sticks out to the Shredder.
Yeah. I guess he gets to do an extra wall growth with this move. Ooh. I just don't feel the wall growth matters that much.
Okay, well, this is something that, like, you know, Tyus does take some root roots different from most people.
Well, it doesn't matter on his next turn, but it matters on the turn after that. He can't hero power again, so that's pretty nice. Oh, no
uproot.
Uproot.
Riot.
All right, well, Dr. Boom comes down.
Pretty good against Ancient of War.
Can you ignore the Dr. Boom and just go aggressive?
It does seem like it's. Oh wait, there's no swipe. I was thinking you could trade 3-2 and swipe.
The swipe would have been better to save here. Funny enough.
Yeah.
Force of Nature isn't quite as useful.
Oftentimes, swipe is better. Swipe is a very good card.
Often it is, but I think it's rare that it is against the Druid.
Yeah.
I think it's the Druid. Force of Nature is usually better to clear.
It's a hard decision.
Is it too risky to simply let your opponent deal with the trades, play like another
Ancient of War, and then keep her the...
You have 11 mana next turn for 10 damage burst, yeah. So that way you could Druid the Claw.
You could just innervate. Go for it here, right? With all the damage, just don't even innervate out hero power.
Yeah, just
and then save. Just face everything.
Aww. Wow.
With all the minions, so he's playing this conservative
always
style,
lucky.
So.
Dang.
Gonna hero power down the line. He's scared of Savage Roar. Savage Roar, the 1/1s get a lot of value.
You're right. The Savage Roar would
punish him a little bit.
Punish him very hard.
But yeah, he's just definitely going to
face it. He wants a dragon or face.
That's the big thing here. That's actually not bad because of swipe, but the big thing here is that if Dr. Boom trades in, he has a keeper to deal the last 2 damage with this line. To kill a 7/2.
This is pretty awkward.
Yeah, this sucks. There's really not much you could do. There's not much you could do besides play your own Ancient of War, actually.
Right. Yeah. That's too much damage to be taking if you just play something else.
The Drake swipe isn't really great here. Another line that's fairly reasonable, I think, that Tyus actually might take is play his own Druid the Claw and taunt form and swipe one and then trade. Because that way you actually get to remove one.
Yeah.
Oh, that's true.
That's a pretty decent line. It forces the Ancient of War to bump into something, and then he could get Dr. Boom twice value to hit.
We know there's a keeper, but it doesn't know that.
Oh, you're right, the keeper. So... keeper, and that gives him enough mana.
Oh, the inner bait! Now he can hero power down the four six with keeper and still have mana to play the Druid Claw.
Yeah.
Is that what he wants to do, though? I feel like he can just force and keeper with Innervate, and that just clears everything.
Yeah, keep it.
And you have a 9 health taunt then.
No, this is he still gets to clear everything with this.
Yeah, but he keeps 9 health on the taunt.
Yeah, but he gets to help another minion.
But it's like, instead of keeping 4 health on his Ancient of War, he gets a 4-6.
Exactly.
Which is, like, pretty good, considering that, you know, this plays around, like, the Keeper of the Growth.
You're
playing
your slower stuff first, also your fast stuff later. Like, especially if you top deck Savage Roar, you still have the combo, and also, yeah, you play your slow minions first. I guess, charge. Yeah,
charging is okay. Like, I think charge
except for lethal.
Kind of doesn't really matter, but...
combo? That might be good.
That helps him clear.
Yeah, it does allow him to clear, actually.
He does take 5 damage in the process, though.
Yes, he has to take 5 damage in the process.
So he would be dead to a swipe or...
swipe force.
Or savage draw.
I feel like that might be his best chance.
Wait, swipe has been used twice on Trump's side, hasn't it?
No, it was once on Tyus, once on
Okay.
Trump. If Trump plays... or if Tyus plays the Ancient of War, can he also survive? His opponent did use Keeper just now.
Yeah. Something interesting is that Trump has actually had 2 Ancient Wars, huh?
Yes. Ash Rifko writes it down on his iPad. For scientific
use. Need to get that info. I just realized
you gotta save that silence.
Yeah.
Alright, well, his best chance is... I mean, he has a pretty good hand after this. Relative to...
yeah, he can taunt up, he can draw, he can heal.
If Trump blinks out here, we'll see. It all comes down to this. Because the Ancient of War.
Yeah, the Ancient of War is pretty...
once the Ancient of War comes in, you're like locking out so much damage.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, until Trump draws a Savage Roar again, and then your opponent can still kill him.
Yeah.
Yes, you absolutely can.
So actually still close. What if he gets a swipe? Oh, big game here, a little too late.
Yeah. No, Tyson's the one who played Dr. Boom, right? He's not going to BJ.
Swipe is 1 off lethal, I believe. 2 off lethal because he can't hear power.
If Tyus had top deck to swipe, he could Azure Drake into swipe here. I don't think he can go for it now. It's way too risky.
Yeah.
But this Ancient of War can get a lot of mileage because you can also heal that minion if you feel like it. It's a little bit risky because of Keeper of the Grove, but I think this is a big turning point here.
Yeah, the BJ's a nice touch where it improves some lethal
Savage
options.
Roar!
Oh, that's bad.
Trump is feeling... actually, I just realized Trump is feeling heat, too, because he's only at 16, and there's 9 damage.
9 damage,
So from Trump's perspective, he's going to die this turn. Like, Trump has to feel like he's going to die if he doesn't...
he dies no matter what to combo.
Yeah, but it's not just combo. It's, like, just part... like, little things will actually kill him if he doesn't force nature.
Tyus can also draw for it, too. He can use Ancient of Lore into Savage Roar, right? And then end the game.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, he'd be 1 off because he can't hero power.
He has to Azure Drake into Savage Roar.
I feel like Trump is actually going to have to force nature here and just try to...
he can clear. He can clear.
Yeah, I'm saying he has to try for that because then it lowers his chance to win after.
Oh, man.
It's painful.
Yeah, it is. He has to actually play the Darnassus first. That's really important, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, he might mess up.
Wait, are you sure? I think it's still 2 out of 9.
No. If you trade first,
you become 1 out of 9?
You become... oh, wait.
I think it's 2 out of 9. Oh, we'll see.
I don't know. Oh, wow.
I like it. I think it sets up more opportunities for lethal.
It plays around one of the combo pieces, but not around both.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's cool.
He doesn't need to. Very good play. Do you heal here as the Ancient of War? You know your opponent just left top decking.
Yeah. It looks like the most reasonable thing is probably heal and put the shade and trade for one of them. Maybe you go face.
Do they get...
if you heal and then you just go face and put the shade...
I think face is fine.
You know that...
although you died a Savage Roar.
You died a Force of Nature as well. No, you died too much there.
Yeah, second Force and Savage Roar.
Tyus knows that he has the Aggro Drake still.
That's gonna be cycled.
That's gonna be cycled, huh?
Has to be cycled. You don't win if you wrath and trade, and then you're not doing anything this turn.
Yeah, that's true.
You have to do more than that.
Yeah. Oh! Second force was the draw. So
that almost is something.
Tice avoided lethal by doing that.
Trump can clear out.
He also has, like, I wonder if he's going to put his opponent, like, wait, you have to kill me. Man. Like, basically, he knows the remaining cards in his opponent's hand now, and he might be thinking that he holds onto this force of nature.
There's no way that Trump can all face here, right? He has to kill the Ancient Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
good. There's no point. You actually just defeat yourself. So I think he's going to be aggressive and hope that his opponent doesn't have it.
Well, it feels like Trump is just playing the same game as Vice with one turn behind. And at this amount of life totals, it seems like Vice is going to come out ahead. Well, he gets a redraw. He gets a redraw, though.
Yeah.
Okay, he gets to draw something.
The Astrodrake.
Oh,
wow. That's pretty okay.
How
for
many Force Natures does Trump use?
Two.
He's used two. He's used two Ancient of Wars, two Force Natures.
There's no six
damage,
right?
Actually unlikely he dies, yeah. So probably
you can just
play
out everything.
You have to trade. If you don't trade, you'll
trade
die.
The shade. There you go.
It's okay. Even if Trump hero powers, then he still can't. He takes a 3 damage from the shade still.
I don't know if this hero power is consequential.
I feel like you play the Astrant. You die anyways against the Force Nature, even though there's not any
life.
It's but
not,
like 6 and 7 is not any different, right? Druid has a lot of ways to deal 4 damage and a lot of ways to deal 6 damage.
The thing is, if you don't play as Aspirin, you don't threaten lethal.
Yeah, I don't see
you'll
why
be, you'll be
2
off, I think. Because you'll have 11, 12 damage next turn. Your opponent will hero power once.
You also lose a lot of pressure if Trump gets like a Druid.
No, you'll be
claw.
One off. You'll be one
what
off.
What is Tice thinking about here? Like, well, if he doesn't play, I don't see why you would not play the Aspirin.
He's just counting. I mean, it's been a long day for Nilum. They've been playing so many games. Yeah. And if they win this series, they're going to go on one more.
Oh my god.
Wow, Wrath for one keeps him alive.
Pretty good.
This is okay. This is starting to get crazy.
Do you need... No, you have you used 2 swipes? No.
He's used 1 swipe.
No, maybe he needs to use it on the Darnassus.
Oh, the Savage Roar. Wait, if he gets Druid the Claw, then he's let's at least...
He's not dead, right?
No.
3, 5, 9, 10 damage. So Trump is not dead.
Tice needs 4 more damage.
Tice needs a top deck.
His second swipe.
Why didn't he? Why don't he Savage Roar there? Because if he gets a swipe and Tice gets a taunt,
to Druid the Claw.
No lethal.
That's no lethal. So
but if that would have been a taunt creature, then Trump got swiped, then he would have lost. And with Druid the Claw, it's still the same damage.
Maybe it's things like Ancient Lore Heal or something.
Maybe
where you need the extra damage from Savage Roar.
No, he'd still be off if that was the case. Taunt. This is another chance for Trump. 4 damage.
No! Dr. Boom, one.
Wait, can he Shredder? No. Wait, he can Shredder.
Yes.
He can Shredder? He can Shredder.
No, but you die.
He dies. Because he'll be at 1.
No, he can... Oh, right, he can't. He can't play Dr. Boom and pop the Shredder. No. What if he got Doomsayer and then killed everything with it?
But then you'll be at 1, die to hero power.
Basically, you needed 2 more mana to get Doomsayer and have the 2 Boombots kill Tice.
Yeah.
But he doesn't have 2 more.
Yeah.
He
doesn't have 2
exactly.
more.
Exactly. Dr. Boom just came a little bit too late for Trump.
And it is not Doomsayer.
Actually, not that bad of a card because Druid will be hero powering. What a crazy back and forth game.
Super, super close. Great plays from both players. And, in the end, Tice just edges out just ever so slightly. But it could have gone either way there with some draws from Trump. We know at least of the swipe and the Druid of the Claw. I think there were 1 of each of those.
Maybe even a keeper with a... I think it would have done it. What, 3?
Savage
or... No,
Savage Roar was 3 damage.
Be one off, right?
One
off.
It was
keeper.
Yeah.
Pretty close.
He needed 4 more damage, but...
Yeah, I think that was the only way.
Yeah. Wow, they're really doing it! The comeback boys. Can they do it from all the way in the quarterfinals? Like, they're with 3rd place spot, which means the most games possible in this tournament. Can they do it from that to go to the finals? And even win. That's...
Maybe we'll get our wish.
Strecker will say
everyone.
No, but I think it's possible.
You're gonna have to face, if this continues, you're gonna face like a war-torn, like, Tice just aged 35 years and grew a beard.
A ragtag band of warriors.
It's like the movie Fury or something. Like they're like in their last tank and trying to survive.
No, they haven't got it yet. It is 2 points left that they need to get that six. And those last few points are the hardest ones to get. Though in this situation, maybe not so. The patron warrior, piloted by Life Coach, seems to not have had too much trouble recently. And Freeze Mage, well, maybe some trouble there.
Freeze Mage is still going to hit some weird matchups, but yeah, I guess now that Druid's gone, just play whatever you want. It really doesn't change much. I guess the Priest still struggles, like you're saying.
I don't know if the Priest struggles. The Priest is like okay versus Patron. It's okay versus...
Yeah.
I mean, you saw the Gar game. Gar played extremely well.
Yeah, but Tux also got like awkward draws during that game.
Gar got awkward draws during that game.
He did too.
Normally the Priest just does a bunch of damage or draws a lot of cards at the start, and Gar did neither of those things. He just pressed the end turn button four times.
It's true.
So that is the big difference. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
As far as a Rogue, though, again, that's another wild card. And there's so much RNG involved in these matchups and decks. It's just, we'll have to see how they pin up against each other and maybe narrow it down a little bit better.
I'm digging the Rogue. Actually, the Druid, again, has like the best chance against both these. If you're anticipating Patron, though, maybe you can sneak out the Rogue. But I think Druid has the best overall field percentage. Percentages against the field game.
Yeah, it is pretty good against both decks.
Yeah.
How neck and neck is this? Nihilum goes up 2-1, then Valuetown goes up 3-2, and now they're up 4-3.
I think Nihilum is very far ahead now, mm-hmm. looking at the matchups.
Are these last few points just much more valuable than the first few?
I don't think so. When it comes down to like a deck that's actually like has no good matchups anymore, mm-hmm. it could be very hard for Kibler to pull out the final Priest win.
Oh, it is Rogue versus Mage. This is, I think, a slightly tough matchup for the Rogue, but absolutely not impossible.
Yeah, the Rogue actually has no incentive ever to attack with, like, its big built-up weapon. Mm-hmm. So you can have, like, an 8-2 dagger, and you just, like, wait for the final deadly poison. Okay, now we go.
It's just, most combo decks that do like a huge amount of burst just get countered by Ice Block as a card.
Mm-hmm.
So usually the game is won when you just have stuff that gets a little bit out of control,
mm-hmm.
and the mage is just always behind on tempo. Mm-hmm. But if you get kind of those hands that fizzle out and you're not really having those tempo mid-game turns, you just lose automatically.
Yeah. I think the key is to see... Oh, he has Lotheb. Okay, that changes a lot.
It does help a lot to try to counter the second block.
Really powerful to time. And it's not even about countering the second block. Just, I mean, you're right. It can also come out to make sure to make the second block hard. But like, you realistically could build up enough damage by like turn 7 and then just threaten to kill if you can get oils and stuff
together. Oh, wow.
It's a really flexible card, the Lotheb. If you pull far enough ahead early, minion-wise, you can just slam it at some point and lock up the spells.
Well, there's Emperor and Antonitus. They're the players again.
Yeah.
With the trophy. Someone's taking that.
Some team is taking that.
Someone is taking that temporarily, I would imagine.
That's true. Or maybe they leave it here, just kind of like as a Stanley Cup kind of thing.
All right, well...
this is really powerful. You follow up the teacher with a prep sprint, and then...
Probably. You really just hope this sticks, but I don't think it's going to.
Fireball it.
You don't have to do that, though.
You should.
Because you have board clears.
I think you should, though. Like, you don't take this fire teacher lightly. Yeah. The 1-1s, if you think about it, it's like as if every spell summons more minions for damage. And
yeah.
It's like, if you ever underestimate the 1-1s, just look at Muster for Battle. And just like look at how much that can do.
Yeah, especially with Prep Sprint and Turn 4, would have been like drawing cards while developing a board at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been perfect.
Okay, so he's got Oil, he's got Deadly Poison. Something that he can legitimately like start building because he has... Like, he just needs to have a minion stick.
Mm-hmm.
Which you can also even make a case for, like, Lotheb. Lotheb will almost ensure that a minion will stick. Mm-hmm. So that way you can put an oil on it. So there's, like, a lot of versatility to making sure that you can get the oil damage in.
Sap is also a really interesting card against Freeze Mage. If Freeze Mage has one of those cards, just has too much card draw, mm-hmm. you can often just kill something with Sap, and it's really funny.
Yeah, actually, it gets to that point, too. Like, you can hit the Acolytes and the Loot Hoarders and stuff. For Tice's spot, he's going to be looking at making sure that Like, Ice Bear is pretty important because they're most likely going to do 20 damage from weapon flurries and stuff. And, like, freezing the face doesn't really matter. Mm-hmm. But the Ice Barriers basically negate that weapon damage. So they have to make it up through minions.
Mm. Well, what to do here? You don't, like, you kind of want a creature to stick, and Lothep's always going to stick, but yeah. It feels like such a waste to actually play the card right now.
It's, like, okay if you Lothep and backstab, but mm-hmm. SI is also fine, too, because it gives you a minion, and you get the re-dagger. Like, ultimately, as long as you're keeping something on the board, it's fine. And this does somewhat challenge the Thorzin next turn.
Is Tharsin good enough to play right now? You kind of just have to pressure the board, so yeah. You never really mind it.
Ah, this is a terrible Thorzin hand. It's like, where's your burn? Like, I guess you have Antoninus Frost Nova.
Yeah, that's about it. And you also can just draw into 2 mana worth of spell later on.
Yeah, but like, the thing that you're never happy to make Thorzin cheaper is like, secrets. You'd rather just have Mad Scientist.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you spend 2 out of your 8 cards just making yourself stay alive longer. You want to have the actual meat to the bones, like the frost bolts, the ice lances. And so Tice, yeah, I agree with him. I don't like using Thorzin there. 2 oils. Now that's a lot of damage. If he can just like deadly poison oil and then just attack with the SI now.
Just do the one. It seems fine. It's just a lot of damage just to get the mage a little bit lower.
But don't attack.
Welcome back, Strefko.
Yeah, Strefko stepped out for a break. And yeah, we'll actually get someone else in just a second here. The SI7H, like, again, you're going to have to make up for about 20 damage or so with minions. Your Blade Flurry will be hitting for around 10, maybe even a little bit, or maybe even a little bit more via spell power, but generally like 20 damage.
All right, well, that's a spell that it can hit, and it's not too bad a one if you do Emperor Tharsin here. But you don't really want to take this 6 damage again.
No, nor do you really feel like Flame Strike is something you can toss away easily.
Maybe it's just time for a Frost Nova Doomsayer to take back board control, and then just do a clean Emperor next turn.
Yeah, you can actually Frost Nova Doomsayer and then ping, and then that gives you the opportunity of, like, if he just chooses to do, like, a sprint again,
mm-hmm.
then you can just ping that down without having to worry and play Emperor. That gives some flexibility.
I think that has to be the best play.
The only problem with that is there's no guarantee that, like, your opponent can just load up with like more annoying minions like Shredder. And that's actually a good time to Lothep, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Lothep would actually really screw him over here. But he does still have the block up, so with Emperor Thorsum mm-hmm. down, Alistraza could come down, and then you haven't proc'd the block, and this is the disaster case, actually. Yeah. I think because of the disaster case, you have to save Lothep to follow up against Alistraza.
Yeah, now that Thorzin's been dropped, the rules change a little bit. It's like, all you want to do now that Thorzin's been dropped is to not play Lothep on his Alistraza turn. That's like the only time you don't want to drop it. Now, you can make a case before and after, but basically now you should not drop Lothep, just in case he drops Alistraza on 8. And then you're like, oh, wow, that was a waste of a Lothep.
What about just like sap and oil again?
Okay, well, he's basically banking that he doesn't have Alistraza. Sap and Lothep is basically like forcing him, like basically gambling that he doesn't have Alex. Because if he does, then it's like he committed to this line and then Lothep actually has 0 impact.
I think he's calculating if he has lethal, but I think if he did, he missed it. I think it involved an oil there.
Here. Okay, so the flurry can be used because he has a second flurry.
Mm-hmm.
And he's right that his opponent doesn't have Alistraza. It's always a scary thing. It just
but he does have Frost Nova.
He does have Frost Nova. Oh, and Doomsayer. Oh, that's so sick. Alright, well,
if anything, this just stops the damage, which is pretty nice.
Kind of. There's 2 Eviscerates.
Yeah, that's Shield Bot's
pretty big too. Can he pop the block?
I don't think so. I don't see how this block is being popped without
him. Yeah, he can, I think, right? He can eviscerate twice in Blade Flurry.
Blade Flurry what?
With his weapon. So like he... Oh no, that's 10 mana, excuse me, sorry.
Damn.
I thought he had the weapon up already. So then he could have attacked and then Blade Flurried for the 12th bit of damage.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well, you never really want to sap a Doomsayer, but I mean, hey, what can you do?
So I guess you just oil now then, and then attack.
Yep.
start the damage train again.
Yeah, you do this to make sure that your opponent can't just freeze your face and then you're denied the 4 damage. If they frostbolt you.
What a greedy SI7.
9-2.
He wants all the oil.
Yeah. Well, it turns out it makes you a lot of money in our world.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure the US government will come after him in a little bit.
Uh-oh. Alright, well, here you actually have another Frost Nova Doomsayer combo if you really want.
A Flamestrike can also make a case, but I guess...
It's just nice to take back tempo with Doomsayer. Like, whenever Doomsayer sticks, you get an open board Archmage.
Well, Archmage Frost Nova gets him some impact as well. I think he's feeling like he just needs to find a way
actually,
to get
that back. Sucks. If he does Archmage Frost Nova, he's going to lose. Because he's going to get his proc, his block proc, and he's going to lose Antonitis at the same time.
I still like the Frost Nova Doomsayer, because that gives you the opportunity to develop Mad Scientist and like ping the Slowthab Anticipation for Flamestrike.
Mm-hmm.
But I can understand why you'd want to do this, because he feels like he has almost
no chance. The Ice Lance makes the difference, though.
Not really, because of Blade Flurry, though, right?
Yes. Oh, does he have 2 Eviscerates, though? Yeah, he does. Okay, never mind.
The Blade Flurry...
looks grim.
Yeah, and the only thing, though, is that...
you proc and block at 4, which is not ideal, but you gotta do it.
Prep Fant, just to draw another card. Maybe he can have SI7 Agent close the gap a little bit more. Okay. So, he ends up just killing the Antonitis, popping the block. This is tough for Tice. He doesn't have any freeze left. He has a blizzard.
Mm-hmm. He has a blizzard and an ice block.
The fact that he's at 4 is pretty nice. And he
has a blizzard. He has the Flamestrike right now.
Yeah, he still has. I'm saying he's out of freeze effects.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? That's actually pretty relevant because he could Flamestrike ping and then play Doomsayer or ice block or, you know, I guess if he's feeling ambitious.
I think I like the just the ice block. Like, it's hard to do 4 damage after you've seen 2 Blade Flurries, 2 Eviscerates, 2 Oils. How do you do 4? You have to do it two card combos. And he only has 2 cards.
Yeah, it has to be Deadly Poison number 2. No, because he can't dagger attack and do that.
It has to be
like Deadly Poison.
Deadly SI.
SI, yeah. Or...
There's only 1 SI left.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Alright, looks like he is going to block and Mad Scientist with this play. I guess Thais thinks he can win the attrition game, and well, maybe he can.
Yeah,
I really like the Mad Scientist over this, though.
I think he wants to just draw his Alexstrasza. Like, 4 is just too low for comfort, and you need to hit the biggest minion possible.
It is, but there's no damage spells left.
Yeah.
So if you can get Ice Barrier up, that's good enough.
That's true. Fan does allow him to keep cycling. No SI7 agent. That's another turn for Tice, which could make all the difference, especially if he picks up Alex. I mean, both these guys have drawn a lot of cards.
It's going to be like the longest 4 health ever. It might just be 5 turns. It's possible. It really is.
Ooh, that helps. That helps a lot.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly useful.
I think you literally can't die. You can't get your block proc right now because the only direct damage left is SI7.
SI7 and...
And you can't modify that with spell damage.
Yeah, unless he's playing some weird thing.
Shiv like, or something.
Yeah, Shiv. Or if he's playing like Undercity Valiant or whatever.
Mm-hmm. There's absolutely no way he's playing that card.
No, I'm just saying like that's the only way he could get direct damage.
Mm-hmm.
You know what he needs? He needs a Nightblade.
Why do the Mad Scientist get played? It actually does nothing.
That's right, all secrets have been weeded out.
Right. And Dog even knows that.
So, he has Violet Teacher now. So, he can Violet Teacher Sap, Backstab. That gives him 4 mana. So, he can play a Shredder, too. That's pretty resilient to AoE. But then, you give up Sap, number 2. I don't know. I'm not sure if I'd like that as much. Farseer and Healbot's pretty nice.
Wow, 11 health swing.
The thing is, like, he's not going to need it because it's very clear his opponent's going to play Alexstrasza on himself.
Yeah, we're just not playing the don't get bursted down game right now. Yeah. We're playing the attrition game. In terms of draws, I think even though Tice only has eight, yeah, Dog actually has four cards left.
Wait. Tice, what if Tice gets enough damage to kill his opponent if he gets Alexstrasza? Like, would he draw enough if he had to? Did he use Ice Lance already? He did.
Yes, he used one Ice Lance already.
Okay, never mind. Because I was like wondering, maybe he could draw, because he has 13 right now. And he used his Thanos? Or is that the, has he not yet? Because Icebox not pop, so if he hits Alexstrasza and he hypothetically has damage to burn his opponent, he might go for it.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, probably doesn't have it though.
Yeah, I don't think Tice is really a risky kind of player. I think this game has shown exactly that he's not.
This is probably Flame Strike into Acolyte. I don't know how close he is to fatigue damage though, but I think it might not matter. I think his priority is to draw.
I don't even know if I like Acolyte.
You like Doomsayer better? Just to set up for...
Nah, never mind, I like Acolyte.
The Doomsayer is better for an Alexstrasza setup.
It is, but, okay, goes to Doomsayer. I guess he's scared of stuff being played.
He's probably really close to the end of his deck.
Mm-hmm.
If I were to guess, he has, like, five cards or less. And I would guess Rogue is the same.
Well, Tice has seven. He had eight before he drew, right? So he has seven, and Dog has three. Yeah.
Okay. So the Dog has three cards.
Yeah. Dog is the one who's really under
He sprinted twice.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. This is literally, like... Like climbing up a hill with weights on you. It's like how do you get past?
What do you think about just playing a shredder?
I mean the shredder is your best chance for damage here. Both shredders are reasonable.
All right.
He is cautious about playing the Thanos though, because it draws him closer to fatigue. Just have to be careful about it.
That sucks.
Wow. A Druid of the Saber, which can get pinged down. A heal blockage drawn.
Yeah, that's huge.
That's really big. Now it's not like now he would be like out of fatigue range in a sense. He doesn't now he doesn't even have to Alexstrasza himself. He can Alexstrasza his opponent.
I really don't think it matters. I think you literally just dealt with every card in the rogue deck. I think that's just it.
He just ran out of damage.
Yeah. There's literally nothing to be done here. Oh, as I said.
I mean, he's still... like, maybe you're in the case where you don't care if the SI or if the Acolyte draws cards, right?
I mean, no, you
do.
You have a Blizzard, you have an Alexstrasza as a body. Like, just those two cards alone deal with the entirety of Doc's deck.
I think you just have to load up the board and go ham. Six cards remain. One card.
So what's the play then?
I think it's... Like go as much board as you can, like Teacher, Dagger, Shredder, maybe even SI instead of it, because you want SI to get...
I think you have to Deadly Poison to kill the 3-3, so I think you Teacher, Deadly Poison...
Oh, he didn't have the weapon already.
Right, and then SI.
Yeah, so SI weapon with the Teacher.
Tice is actually counting the amount of money he's going to win.
1,000, 2,000, 3,000... what comes after 3,000?
4,000? Whoa. But yeah, I don't see how Dog can possibly win this game. It's gonna require, like, Lorewalker Cho right now.
Or maybe, like, Vitality Totem stuff.
Oh, man.
And then, like...
Oh, no, Patient Assassin could actually trade as Alexstrasza.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, this is not a good draw, the second Acolyte. He needs to get Alex right here.
Yeah.
Alex could steal it.
He actually doesn't need to. He just keep going, really. Like, that's okay. Whatever.
Maybe he pings...
No, he's winning the fatigue game.
He's going to fireball the Teacher, right?
Playing the Acolyte actually put him in a bit of trouble. Because he can even out in the fatigue game. And Dog might be able to heal out, but no. He has...
Right, but
unless Tice forgot to put an Alexstrasza on the deck.
Now he has another... No, now he has enough damage to, like... To legitimately contest with Alexstrasza. So I don't know. I think fireballing the Teacher is still the ultimately better play because it's just removing the threat. Mm-hmm.
I like the Frostbolt too. You still have value from Ice Lance because you think you have a Blizzard in the deck.
Yeah. Wow. So Dog's on his last card. What is his last card?
Probably not good.
Another Farseer?
There it is.
Wow.
It's the last card that reveals the next card.
Just simply has not enough damage. There's no, like, infinite damage source. Needs, like, Ragnaros or something.
And Tidus is okay with just keeping this stall. Because the key is, like you said, the Alexstrasza.
Mm-hmm.
And if he gets Patient Assassin.
Counters the Patient Assassin.
Patient Assassin. No!
Oh, wow, that's so bad.
Ooh, man.
The draw punish. The only card Dog can play hits him in the face for eventually a lot.
Cone of Cold.
Probably eventually like 6 damage.
You can lock it up with the ping. And that last card from Dog is his last hope. I mean, he's going to play it. But I guess that's it. He's just going to concede, realizing he can't pull it off.
Yeah, there really isn't much to do. That was a pretty crazy game. It looked like Tice had that unlocked the whole time, but with Rogue being so unpredictably powerful with the tempo swings, you're never really sure. Though we were pretty sure about halfway through.
It's like really dependent on making sure Rogue can get that extra damage in preemptively, and you saw that he got like all the weapon damage in, which is like 20 total.
Yeah.
Just he can't get that extra 20 or so because you gain so much life through ice blocks and ice barriers.
Yeah, Rogue just has a limited amount of damage. It's much more than before. I think before GVG, whenever warriors run up against it, they just play basically the freeze mage game with the armor up every single time. And the only way rogues could win was with Assassin's Blade. And seems to be like a situation like that against freeze mage these days.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're joined by Forsen right now on the Strife for One.
There we go.
It's been a long series.
Understanding.
So
yeah. He's casting Life Coach up there also. Those can tend to get quite long.
Why are you hating, bro?
What? I'm not hating. Life Coach is one of my favorite players.
Okay.
It's just can be exhausting to cast him sometimes, you know?
It is.
And play against him.
It's nothing. Play against him. I mean, even Life Coach will probably admit that.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of Life Coach playing, he will have to be playing right now.
The next 3 games, at least.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He has to win 1 game of 3 with Patron Warrior for Nihilim to advance to the finals.
Ooh.
What odds are you giving him? Realistically.
I would say they're pretty good, actually. I would say.
Wow!
I
mean,
wow! Thank you for your insight, Carson.
I mean, Rogue can deal with Green Patron quite easily.
What's the weather like, Ollie? It's gonna rain.
It's Green Patron after all. Come on, guys! Like, so they all have fair matchups, really. Like, the Rogue is quite all right. It's not favored versus Green Patron if you play correctly, but it's still all right with the Blade Flurries if you get them in time for the Green Patrons. So I would say it's not 50% for sure, but it's like, it's not much under 40.
Actually, Monk's stats said that it was actually over 50%. The Rogue is favored.
No, I'm talking 50%. About the chance of him comebacking in this series, you know, winning all 3.
Okay. All right.
Oh no, the opposite. I mean, that they win against this Green Patron 3 times.
Yeah.
So that's what I mean. So.
All right. Well, Kibler's not too happy. But what can you do?
I mean, it's not unreasonable. It's the fact that you get a curve. You have minions to play. That's such a risk if you throw away the Azure Drake and then Twilight Guard's 2/6.
I think Execute is such a valuable card because those buffed minions otherwise never exit the board.
It's true. Would you keep the Azure Drake at all,
Forsen? I mean, you have a lot of dragons, actually. Like, I don't think you need to keep the Acid Drake. You're gonna get something by that turn. You don't have the coin, so you don't have the possibility to coin out the Twilight Guardian anyway. So I don't think that Acid Drake is a keep. I would go for the 3 drops, actually.
You do draw 5 cards by turn 4, so it's like you have a high chance of getting into a dragon.
There's a lot of early drops as the agent, and
how about that? Life Coach just kept Inner Rage, Execute, and Grim Patron.
Yeah, well, he knows that this is a slow matchup, so...
I mean, I thought you'd keep Execute, but Inner Rage and Patron seems really surprising.
Yeah, it's kind of alright in this matchup, but other matchups, you don't want to really keep those combo cards that early on. You want to go for the weapons, usually.
Mm-hmm. The other interesting thing is that in the previous game, in the set that we saw Kibler play his Dragon deck, he drew a lot of cards and did not stumble into that Light Bomb that we know was in there in the previous set of games, but because they were able to change the decks, it is actually possible he did not include Light Bomb in this variation.
It's true. There is a possibility of it, but I know that it's one of Kibler's like more fond cards. Like, he was always talking so much about it, how like Light Bomb is one of those like format defining cards. Of course, it didn't end up being that way, but he was really high on it.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike like Dr. Boom and Patron, for example.
which are actual format binders, and Mysterious Challenger. But you get like 1%, right? Yeah. Pretty much, is that the case?
Yeah.
A weapon would have been really good here.
Yeah.
It might have been regretting not looking for those War Access or Death Spite right now, but it still has a good amount of answers with Slam and Inner Executes.
For is it Slam removal, or is it Cycle?
How much damage are you willing to take here? I mean, you don't have a Death Spite, mm-hmm. so if you had a Death Spite, you probably wouldn't Slam. You probably would just wait and then kill it. But he doesn't have any... Okay. Yeah.
Just slow down the game some more.
Exactly. I think a Slam here is fine. He has Battle Rage to cycle for more cards, sure. So a Slam is totally fine here.
Well, the Slam for the Cycle.
He actually wants
the
Cycle right now.
Yeah. He wants the weapon that bad.
That Whirlwind is not bad at all with the Green Patrons and Inridge.
Oh man, 3 drop on 3.
Yeah, this is pretty 8. Good draw.
And he's got the 4-5-6.
Yeah.
Alright, Execute though. He can clear.
I suppose so. How big is it to keep the Execute though against all of this stuff? Like, I feel like against Dragon Priest, you really want to save it for the Twilight Guardians, like the really problematic taunts.
Yeah, and it's quite common to have the Twilight Guardian on turn 4. So I guess he just wants to be able to deal with that efficiently.
Well, Life Coach is really conceding a lot of damage this game. I think we've seen this so far a few times, and in every one of those times, the two Warsong commanders are in the bottom like 5 cards.
Oh, really?
So you just got withered away and lost. So we'll have to see if it happens the third time.
I love Life Coach's expressions, man.
He's really confused about this opening vocabulary. You got the 1-drop, 2-drop, and 3-drop?
Oh man, it's just too funny to me, man. His eyes get bigger by every turn. He just keeps increasing in size.
So he's gonna go in clear here, which is totally fine.
That's fair enough.
Did he just double execute?
Yeah. I guess I would have used Inrage instead, but he values maybe
a patron board.
Yeah.
Right. Next turn he's gonna coin 2 patrons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But couldn't he have waited like 1 turn really to get a few more patrons?
I guess he didn't want the buff for the Dark Cultist in case he played a minion, because then he would have to deal with the buffed.
The buffed creature. Minion can always.
I like how impressed Kibler looks right now. Is that an image right now?
I don't think so.
Of Kibler?
Yeah.
Wait.
No, he's gonna blink.
No, it's actually frozen. Yeah. Like, he's super concentrated right now.
No, he's not impressed by Life Coach.
Did you really just double execute my whelps, bro?
Kibler went offline. All right. Well, Life Coach, back to see if he can.
I mean,
go
this
plan.
Was the plan.
Yeah.
You just go for it.
Sure.
It would have been
still
good.
Still not impressed, Kibler.
Yeah, I mean, it would have been good to keep that whirlwind there. It would have been a lot more patrons, you know. So,
but it would be delayed by 1 turn as well, which I don't know if you really had.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you would have taken quite a bit of damage, but it's still priest, so they don't have a lot of burst, really.
So this tells me that Life Coach really doesn't think he's favored. Wow, my
that's
goodness!
That's an insane pickup. Life Coach is not going to be happy about this.
Yeah.
He does get to recycle 2 cards with Battle Rage, but it's still so bad. And he gets War Axe
at least.
Yeah.
Okay. It's not hopeless.
No, certainly not.
And another War Axe.
Emperor.
Oh, and he can Emperor the other War Axe.
Well, the Acolyte gets stolen by the Cabal Shadow Priest the following turns. He used both Inner Rages,
yeah,
and
so
I didn't see Cool Taskmaster, so... I think,
that's true. He might not have Cool Taskmaster.
I think it's gonna be trouble.
Yeah, this is looking not so good for Life Coach right now. That Emperor with only 3 cards next turn in hand, it's not going to give him a lot of value, especially since one of them, or 2 of them, are non-combo cards.
But
so.
It seems fine just because it is a 5-5.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's going to go ahead and recycle for his other combo cards before he plays the Emperor.
Sure.
It kind of has the same playstyle as Freeze Mage, where you want to wait until you get either Antonidas or some spells to use with Antonidas before you play the Emperor. You don't want to use it on just AoEs or War Clears.
Is he going to equip another weapon?
I don't think he needs to. He might want to equip the Deathspike next turn, and then you don't want to waste a charge on the Warhead.
Oh, that's right. I didn't see the Deathspike there. Okay, well, Cabal Shadow Priest will steal this, and Kibler keeps up the pressure, and it's not going to stop, because it's such a minion-based deck that this is exactly what it excels at.
Brute Force. Yeah. Wow. Life Coach has drawn 3 weapons and 4 cards. I think
we need to
realize this.
Cards.
Yeah. And still 0 Warsongs. Are they actually there? You said you saw
one. No, there was. He had an opportunity to Warsong Patron and then decided to just whirlwind twice against the Zoo deck.
Okay. I'll believe you.
I think you weren't casting that series. I think you're taking a break.
Yeah.
Well, here, I guess the Acolyte of Pain is the best chance because your opponent already played the Cabal Shadow Priest.
Mm-hmm. But wouldn't you still want to wait one more turn to get at least two cards from that, though?
You're 14. If you absorb 4 damage, you're totally cool with that.
I think he wants to draw multiple cards with Emperor Thorson.
That is a really good draw as well, Holy Nova, combined with Spell Power Clears, everything.
There's no executes anymore. Like, I don't know how you even clear this board if you're a life coach.
You don't. Brawl. You go for the... Yeah.
Wow. I'm actually surprised they even attack into that.
Yeah, I don't think he wants to give him more cards. And he still has Lethal on board. He knows that there's no executes, so attacking into Acolyte doesn't punish him.
Hmm. Okay.
Well, Dragon Priest prevails against the Patron again. There's really no way he can come back from this.
Yeah.
Just not enough time. Yeah. He can survive one more turn, I believe.
Yeah, but then... Like, what are you expecting? You're not really living. Right.
Yeah.
You need a lot of other cards.
Shield Slam.
Yes, he has 15 damage right now, the Priest. You have to shield block and Hero Power or play the Armor Smith in order to survive. And he's gonna do just like that.
Okay.
So. Actually, he has more because that's 2 points of spell damage. There's a 4 damage Holy Nova, or it was until that kill a dragon.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But he's still lethal. Nope. 2 armor.
It's just barely not enough. Also, if he played Holy Nova, he'd give him 2 more armor.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Well, it wouldn't matter if you killed him with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Getting armor at 0 health is fine. Yeah.
Why not just use Arrow?
You could draw some cards here.
Yeah, drawing cards.
Northshire and Holy Nova to heal everything up.
I think Northshire begins a lose condition though.
Yeah,
the cards that work off a patron.
Yeah, sure, but he can't deal with other big minions, and healing everything up is pretty good. Pretty good.
Yeah, I still don't think Yesera is bad here at
all. No, not at all. Like, he's thinking right now, can he kill me? Obviously, he can't because he hasn't played Emperor yet. And he has 4 cards in his hand.
Yeah, in the worst case scenario, it's Frothing Berserkers with Warsong,
Whirlwind,
and the Ghoul, I think.
2 Whirlwinds. Yeah.
You're playing Whirlwind as well, so.
Yeah, so Unstable Ghoul Whirlwind.
Yeah, there's no way. And he should know that. Oh, he doesn't want to draw cards though, for some reason.
I think he just doesn't want to play Northshire.
Yeah.
Which is understandable.
Yeah, it is.
It's fair. I mean, he's at full health across the board here, and he's still representing lethal. Okay, that's fair. Like, he just doesn't want to give his opponent any chance. In fact, his opponent would have 6 cards because of the
draw.
I'm having a very hard time imagining Life Coach being able to survive.
Yeah, I don't see... Let's see, 4, 5...
So
I mean, you could survive here if you want, if you really want to.
You see, so if you use a Deathbite, attack into the Cabal, and then equip the Fiery War Axe, play the Armor Smith, you can survive.
No, I was thinking
Armor Smith into Cabal and then Frothing into Cabal.
You Warsong and you Deathbite. Exactly. If you Warsong here and you run the Armor Smith into the Cabal, you play the weapon. Wait, what?
No, this is the only way, the one I mentioned. You have to kill the Cabal with 2 creatures, and you gain 2 armor.
Oh yeah, he doesn't have mana to equip War Axe. No, okay, yeah, you're right.
Oh, okay.
That's painful. That is really painful.
Yeah, and now, you're right. There's gonna be a disconnect for true justice!
Oh. I would love to see that, actually.
Alright.
Yeah, is that what Life Coach is holding out for?
No, it doesn't count anymore. Now it doesn't count. Disconnect possibilities are off the table. Alright.
Well, Kibler's done, once again. Finishing out, and if this is where Vow to Town's road ends, finished out pretty strong, honestly. Very good performance in the finals so far.
Yeah, still a bit of play, though.
Yeah.
Would you consider recruiting Kibler for the Forsen boys for the next season?
Oh, I don't know. I can't spoil my precious...
Oh, your strategies.
Yeah. Your potential roster?
Yeah.
You'd have to recruit Kibler's entire team, though.
Yeah.
Oh really? Oh.
They don't go separate ways.
Oh, that might be a problem.
His dog Shiro.
Yeah.
All right. Well, the score is almost evened, but when you have to win two games against Patron, well, it feels better than winning three against Patron.
Yeah. I have to imagine Dog's gonna go up here. In fact, they're high fiving Dog, and he looks defeatedly regretful. Like he's like, I do not want to actually have
please,
to play this.
Please don't send me into life coach again. I don't want to show you guys how bad the Rogue is again.
Yeah.
So he's lost twice with Rogue, right?
Yes. He has lost twice with Rogue. Very marginal losses and really nothing he could do in either of them.
Yeah, pretty much. I think the handlock game was tough. In fact, I think he played that very well.
Yeah.
The Freeze Mage game is more of like a consequence of not being able to get the timing off with Lothar very effectively.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Freeze Mage drew pretty decently in that one. Mm-hmm. So... how do you feel about Rogue versus Patron?
I feel like it's like if you're a really good Green Patron player, you should win it. You should play like everything very efficiently when you need to play it. You need to go for the weapons at all time to remove the threats early on. But it still has like this potential to just play through his gamble of Green Patrons in the start, you know, if you have that in your hand.
Yeah.
But other than that, like if you can't remove the Patrons for one turn, like that turn when they are played, you usually lose that matchup.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You kind of need to just develop something on the board, trigger the Patrons as Life Coach had to play them against the Priest, wipe them out, and your game.
All right, well, one more time. Let's try to see if this Rogue can go through. It's going to be tough, though, because I feel like Life Coach is still playing very on point. He's the one who has all the reason to complain about fatigue, but I think he's in his element.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Dog versus Life Coach.
I mean, this is still a lot on the line. Like, if Life Coach wins this game, all of his team is guaranteed 20k at least.
Yes, you double your prize.
Yeah, you double your prize money from 30 to 60.
I mean, I know that Life
Coach... I mean, this is kind of like real poker.
Life Coach only cares about the first place in this tournament. That's the only thing he cares about. But he still wants to, like, you don't want to let down your teammates who actually cares about the prizes, you know?
Right.
So
for RDU and Tyson,
he has that pressure. Really exactly. He has a lot of pressure in that regards, but... Let's see here. You got an Emperor. Not what you want to have in your starting hand, though.
No, not against Rogue, which is very fast. I think you still want the usual suspects. I think Deathspite's your most important card.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you need to be able to deal with Violet Teachers and Shredders and stuff like that.
Even the Fireworks is okay.
Yeah,
because you're running Double Slam, you're running some Reach cards, and you know he's running Shredders. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really good card. The teacher has always been the problem for Warrior. That's why people started adding it during the Rogue era. But it's a bit easier for Green Patron because they have Whirlwinds, two Whirlwinds. Mm-hmm. So they can clear the plebs easily.
Yep, the Apprentices. Life Coach is really, really thinking on this Mulligan decision. What is there really to think about? Is he thinking about keeping one of those three cards? I don't.
Yeah, he's probably thinking about keeping the Emperor.
Oh, okay. Well...
There we go, that's a
that
great
That is a
start.
Very defensive hand. Very, very defensive hand.
Yeah, that's like good against Hunter.
Yeah.
That's about it. Maybe
an Paladin, great. Have you seen Muster for Battle into two Armorsmiths?
I have, yeah. It's not the most fun thing in the world.
No, it's not.
It's for the Warrior player.
Yeah. So he's right, really considering coining or using the word for some reason.
No, Life Coach likes to do this. And at the start of the game, he really tries to think out the next few turns.
So he's wondering if my opponent, hero powers, do I do this? Do I hero power this turn? Do I play the Armorsmith? Do I even put the weapon in anticipation for something else? Like, if he plays the weapon here, then he sets up for his Acolyte the following
exactly.
turn.
Otherwise, Armorsmith would be the obvious play here. But there's not.
Is there a right play?
Yeah, I would just Armorsmith here because he's not gonna be able to coin another Shredder next turn. Mm-hmm. So he still has one more turn to get that weapon out when he needs it, and you don't really coin out a three drop here. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I mean, not even really like Van Cleef and stuff back in the day was coined out on turn three unless you're trying to.
That could actually happen because
you got some decks.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it generally didn't happen as often. Mm. It's like. Yeah, you used it more in the mid-game.
That was a fun card.
Rip.
Warsong Commander, where have you been?
I mean, he had it the previous game too, when he had to kill his own frog into the priest card. But yeah.
All right. You play the acolyte here. I mean, if you're a control warrior, you always play the acolyte there for sure.
Right.
But I'm not sure.
It does net you some armor.
Mm-hmm.
It's a higher priority target than the armorsmith.
Yeah, it's very likely that Dog has an answer for acolyte of pain, like poison.
I like the acolyte. It just stops a turn 4 play from Dog.
Mm-hmm.
There's no turn 4 play that you would make here.
Yeah, it's super awkward. If he actually plays this acolyte, then he can't really use the rest of his mana efficiently. Mm-hmm. So he wastes 2 mana there if he wants to poison that. So I'm not sure if we're going to see that right now. We might just see the... Oh, there's a Dragster, so it's going to be useful later on.
I don't really like it either, but he can kill the acolyte at the price of 2 cards, 2 armor, if he really, really wants to develop the Shredder. That just seems not worth it.
What he could do here is just Deadly Poison and coin the Farseer.
Farseer. A little bit of tempo.
He could also just coin out the Shredder. I think that the Shredder is the better play.
It seems the better play from Dog, but
he can really backfire,
it's really bad for him because of what Life Coach actually has with the axe. At least in a lot of cases.
Well, yeah, if it drops a 3 attack minion, right?
Yeah.
Even then, you know there's like stuff that does 1 damage.
That's true, and he could have Inner Rage to like buff it, he could trade.
Yeah.
Shredder has a lot of backfire potential.
Yeah.
One thing Dog should also consider is
I think it's also not wrong to backstab here.
Backstab the acolyte?
Yeah.
How so?
It gives him the immediate answer. Like, if he didn't have a weapon before, he definitely has a super high chance of having it if you backstab the acolyte.
All yeah, right. So he's gonna hope for a two power minion, or less.
Even if it's 3, it's okay. Just rolling it.
Oh my god. Oh, Life Coach!
That is the second best, I believe.
After
it's better than Sucker Bus, because she has 4-3.
More health.
Right.
Yeah. Wow, you know what? This is retaliation for Life Coach talking badly about Totem Goto in his card review.
To be fair, it did turn out pretty mediocre. But I'm sure he'll just draw Execute here. It's not a big deal.
So, do you use the Whirlwind here?
Whirlwind, get Inner Rage.
Yeah, I think you do.
Whirlwind and Inner Rage or the Execute's fine.
Inner Rage, you can, yeah.
Inner Rage is great. Inner Rage is a redraw.
Oh, we're just gonna go ahead and play the Armorsmith.
Wow.
Okay, he really values that Whirlwind for the Green Patron that he just picked up.
Man, that is pretty tight though.
Yeah.
He's gonna get a lot of health though if he kills off.
Is health really matter though? I feel like the board tempo is so important. As long as the health doesn't get out of control.
Well, the health really matters for the rogue. The rogue still has to win. It couldn't even beat a 50 health mage.
I don't really think as long as it's reasonable amount of health, it's still gonna be okay.
Yeah.
Well, if you're killing the acolyte here and you're leaving 2 armorsmiths on the board, things often get far less reasonable very quickly.
For sure. I think he's probably going to Blade Flurry here. Backstab one, poison up, attack the other one, and then Blade Flurry. Seems like the best play. He could even double backstab if he wants to, but I think I prefer saying that. Oh, he's actually not. Just getting rid of the Armorsmiths.
Okay, and then play Farseer.
Poison Farseer, yeah. Dealing up the...
Yeah, I mean, is that really... Do you want to give up your Flurry before the Patrons come out?
No, that's the thing. You don't really want to do that. But you would gain a lot of damage potentials.
Yeah.
Like, your War Golem would be at 4 health. He couldn't kill it with his War Axe, you know?
Oh, so he heals the Totem Golem.
Yeah, of course. But now he can still kill it. Yeah, exactly.
Slam time. Let's see what he can get off.
The slam is pretty nice. You can just get rid of the Totem Golem off the board, and the Armorsmith just gets more armor, plus you cycle. It's really like if you want to develop Deathspite, that's the only other choice, and I don't really think it's that great.
There is a clear here where you don't have to use your Armorsmith, and
you have to use Whirlwind though, and he's been very unwilling to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he can slam the Farseer and then Whirlwind axe the Totem Golem, but if he does that, he ensures that his Armorsmith dies to a Dog's weapon anyway,
mm-hmm.
so it really doesn't offer an advantage.
Yeah, but that removes the weapon so that whenever he uses Green Patron, he might have the Blade Flurry, but not the poison anymore. So it's not a bad bait.
That's a good call.
But he decides to get rid of the totem golem with snow. Oh, that's interesting.
Okay. Emperor Thorison.
Yeah, that's an alright card. It kind of works with a few others, I heard.
I like this, actually. He keeps the Whirlwind for the next turn, and he's probably going to be able to get that totem golem off the board to get it with Armorsmith 1 power.
Oh, nice. That is a big draw.
It could have been the best.
It is a big draw.
Yeah.
Another 4.
It gives him some much-needed ammo, as long as he don't pick up other spells.
Well, more running. Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah.
Do backstab here to get rid of that.
Backstab the last one, it would seem fairly consistent.
Mm-hmm.
But now he has a spell damage, so maybe no. Because that's a 3 damage hit, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Next turn he can backstab SI and stuff. So he's got some good plays.
Yeah, he likes the flexibility, it seems.
Not to mention that you're anticipating Thorson coming out, so backstab with Thanos and SI is the perfect removal spot.
And you get to keep your weapon, which is really important for the anytime Blade Flurry if patrons ever decide to get in here.
Yeah, so what do you do here, really? Do you slam the Emperor, or do you equip the Deathbite and deal with the threats first? I mean, you know for a fact that it's very, very likely that the rogue player has the Blade Flurry after using the Sprint there, right?
The rogue player. A Blade Flurry.
But it just hits so many nice cards.
So you don't...
Do you expect to be winning as the warrior from this point in the game unless you'd combo off? I think it's just fine. Like, it's bad, but it's not going to get better.
Yeah, I mean, you have 3 combo cards in your hand, so it's pretty good.
Dude, Dog is so stressed.
Yeah.
He's like blowing his hair every 2 minutes. Oh.
Dogs is thinking about next turn.
It's all those in a rage plays. You know, Dogs like, oh damn, he has an enrage. No, wait, of course he doesn't.
If I was life coach, I'd be like yelling after each play, trying to intimidate my opponent. I scream, 9!
9, 9, 9. So that's pretty good Blade Flurry.
Is it?
You don't need
a Blade Flurry.
Why do you want a Blade Flurry so bad?
You can just fan to clear.
Yeah.
You get, like, the oil on as well, on the minion.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if they don't have the removal, pretty good.
It's true.
But yeah, it's not really needed.
Because he has oil, he can always go for flurry. So he hypothetically could get away with prep sprint as well this turn. But,
prep sprint?
Yeah, like he could flurry here and prep sprint, but like I don't think
he's just thinking about maybe Thalnos backstab SI on the Emperor and just go face again. No, he's gonna go ahead and Phantom Knives.
So he's just gonna SI and then clear?
Yeah.
That's reasonable. I think as long as you get these mid-sized minions so that way the oil can land on them, it's pretty huge.
Yeah, he didn't want Thalnos on the board for Green Patrons. So it's understandable.
Wow, no respect to the armor smell. Never mind, plenty of respect. He wanted me to face to face.
Yeah. Doesn't die to Whirlwind now, which is very, very good.
Mm-hmm. He knows that his opponent could have the Grim Patron combination, but everything on board is strong against it.
He's prepared for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're most likely going to see a Death Sprite here, though, setting up for a really good Green Patron board.
The main thing I fear is Dog's like, okay, well, I'm dead to exactly, like, Frothing, and then Ghoul, and then Whirlwind.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you started thinking about, like, all the possibilities that of what you die to.
Oh, actually, yeah, he's actually calculating how much damage, if he goes face with a Death Sprite here. That's 8 damage from the Death Sprite, it's down to 15, and then he's gonna get, I believe... 4 Green Patrons?
That's 12.
Yeah, so that's very, very close, but I don't think it's a risk you're willing to take when you know that your opponent plays Sealbolt as well. That could really backfire.
Yeah, sometimes even 2. Yeah. I mean, Dog could probably be only playing 1, but he is one of those guys who...
Yeah, he's okay with 3-3. Yeah. Of course, a safer play.
Yeah.
Oh, the Acolyte.
He just wants to draw cards. I think if he gets another like Whirlwind or an Inner Rage, he does amplify his damage a pretty considerable amount.
Ooh, execute on that. Interesting.
No oil targets. It makes sense.
Yep. Keep clearing those minions.
Alright.
So he needs... Oh, that's...
Not bad. Not bad draw. But the problem is that his opponent already has a death spite that's set up.
Mm-hmm.
So you're asking for trouble.
Exactly. Too bad he doesn't have any more backstabs anymore to remove that acolyte. Do you sap the acolyte?
I'm good.
It's not bad.
What if it's actually kind of not bad.
If you sprint, you overdraw by one.
Because you know that the combo, if they had the Green Patron and the Warzone, costs 6. And then he can't play the Acolyte on the same turn as that combo if he saps it now.
Mm.
Yeah, it's true.
They're not allowed.
Talk's not happy.
I mean, you never want to sap like Warzone Commander. You never want to sap Green Patrons, you know, really.
Yeah.
So, and you don't want to sap an Emperor either.
Can you set up a weapon and sprint here?
You could, yeah. But I guess you want to force him to use his weapon. If he doesn't have those Green Patrons in his hand right now, you want to force him to use that Death Spite, even if it means your Violet T-shirt.
Yeah, I like that philosophy. Oh.
He's going to kill the Acolyte, it seems.
Hmm.
Okay. All right, deny the card draw. That's fine.
A very basic play.
Yeah, and sometimes it's the best play.
Oh, in a rage.
There we go, but that's scary, right? You know, your opponent has that four...
What is that? That's lethal, right?
See.
No, he didn't attack face last 18, turn.
6 patrons? Yeah.
Yeah, it is lethal. Oh, you're right.
Oh, actually...
Because of the whirlwind effect.
Oh, yeah, he has
double. Oh, like, Michael's just realizing it right now. He's like, oh.
Yeah.
He's like, let's go, just in case.
Yeah.
That rope might get me again.
He has the Death Bite follow-up hits anyways.
Oh, he's so excited. This isn't going to be game. This is the 6th point that they need.
And that means Nylon's going to go to the Grand Finals and challenge Cloud9 for the Season 1 Championships.
Doggy's not very amused right now.
No, that's a very long journey for Valuetown, but Nylon goes through the gauntlet. They actually... Yeah.
Well, the longest journey has actually been Nylon.
They've been playing for so long. They play since the beginning of today. It's actually coming out to Hour 9 and they're going to the Grand Finals.
Life coach immediately start talking about the game.
Yeah, Dog is like, yeah, let me just go.
Where's the poker table? Later, dude.
Time to start drinking.
A pretty good payday for Valuetown. A great showing, despite the fact that they're not an established franchise at all.
Mm-hmm.
But congratulations to Nylon. They move on. And I mean, if you look at just the power level of their roster, it doesn't surprise anybody to say that they're top 2 in the league.
And Cloud9 gets their wish. They really wanted to play Nylon. They had never played against them since the qualifier stage. And they wanted the victory, and honestly, I think they wanted the slight advantage that they've seen the deck play so many times, and they're probably very fatigued by this point.
Yeah, because Cloud9's decks are still unknown for the other teams, so they have a pretty big advantage coming into this series, though, so it's not going to be easy for Nihilum at all.
For sure. All right.
Well, let's get the two dudes here on the casting bench and see what they have to say before we get into the finals.
Thanks, Forsen, for stopping by.
Thank you.
Hey guys, welcome.
Hello.
Oh man, life coach, again and again, so much pressure.
So much pressure.
Now we can see the intensity. Are you showing off? Is it fake intensity, or are you just like panicking all the time when you're playing Hearthstone?
Yeah, probably the last.
Okay. Well, you guys certainly made it to the finals. The big concern, the reason why Cloud9, I think, primarily wanted you guys, is you guys have been playing this whole day. Do you think the fatigue will impact the quality of play? You think the odds are maybe a little bit diminished because of so many games and so much anxiety today?
Well, I have to say that this it's pretty exhausting playing already. Yesterday we had a lot of matches. Today it's already from the morning until now, so it's probably a bit exhausting. But we are just going to do our best. We still feel pretty well. I think we still play. After so many hours playing, we still feel pretty nice.
Well, you guys have secured 60k for the team, and a lot more is possible if you guys take out Cloud9 in the grand final that's coming up. A lot of games, a lot of weeks to get here, and it's going to be all on this. Well, should be pretty exciting. Hope you guys got it. Mm-hmm. How do you guys think your third teammate, RDU, is holding up? Because he's also been playing this long hours, and he's playing from his home, from Romania, which is like an 8-hour time difference. Like, he's ready to go to sleep, I'd imagine.
Does he know yet? Like, does he know we won?
I don't think he knows it yet.
I think he doesn't know it yet.
He already changed his sleep schedule also together with us to be really prepared for this tournament, same as yesterday. So, he's doing really well, and Yeah.
All right. Best of luck, guys. We'll be back after 6 minutes, 15 minutes.
30.
To get into the grand final. It's going to be Nihilim versus Cloud9. Match to see. Don't miss it.